Thank you, Chris. Good evening. Welcome to the Town of Deerfield Select Board meeting on July 27th, 2016 at 6:30 p.m. Our first agenda item is we have the Housing Authority here and the Redevelopment Authority. So introduce yourselves.
Thank you for allowing us to be part of your meeting tonight. My name is Frances Feeney. I'm the Executive Director for the Franklin County Regional Housing and Redevelopment Authority. And with me today is one of our senior rehab specialists.
Yeah, Brian McHugh. I've been with the agency since 1990. And thank you for having us.
Thank you.
Thank you, Brian, for coming, too.
Welcome.
It's good so we can answer questions. So, Fran, what can you tell us what is different about this block grant than the ones we've had in the past, or is
no,
it about roughly
there really
the same?
Isn't anything. What okay. We're asking is for your participation. It's find out if the town is interested in participating in a regional block grant as you have done in the past.
I think we are, but we have two new members.
Okay.
And I would like you just to explain a little bit to them to why it's important to participate or why it's helpful to participate.
Absolutely. Be glad to.
Thank you.
Community development block grants for a town the size of Deerfield actually don't come to us directly from the federal government as they would if we were a larger community. They come to us through the state of Massachusetts and through the Department of Housing and Community Development. And there's an annual application process. And what type of block grant you apply for depends on the size of your community and how you're rated. So for Deerfield, you would actually apply for, and I think I provided some materials that hopefully help explain. You would be applying for what's called a Community Development Fund 2 application. And we would work with you and the other communities as part of a regional application. And depending on working, you're going to appoint someone on your staff to work, be the point person to work with us. And we would apply for probably a housing rehabilitation program and either a social service or a planning grant as additional. All community development block grant applications are highly competitive, particularly for the CDF2. In last year, the state only allocated $2.7 million statewide for CDF2s. But we think if we put the right communities together, apply for the right types of programs, we'll be able to put together a strong application. Our agency has a terrific road map, has a terrific
track record,
thank you, for getting awards.
Mm-hmm.
In matter of fact, last year for the 2015 applications that we submitted on behalf of some of the regional communities, we had the two highest scoring applications in the state.
Right.
So it does take a lot of work of our staff time. It's going to take a commitment from the town to work together. These are critical funds for the communities, particularly small rural communities. It's the only way we can actually fund housing rehab. And Brian can go into what the housing rehab program does and accomplishes, and it helps so many of our homeowners. Particularly our seniors, those that are most vulnerable. But it also helps fund a lot of the social service programs that help our residents in the community. Fuel assistance programs, home-delivered meals through LifePath, used to be Franklin Community Home Care, County Home Care. Lots of those other types of programs. Also, it's the way, if we were to fund some of planning programs in Irving, this is how they're funding their planning for future senior housing. So, and this town has done that in the past as well.
Mm-hmm.
So, this is a really critical program. It provides essential funding to the communities, and it's something that our agency is we find it's a critical part of our mission.
Mm-hmm.
You said you had a wait list of 6 so far, even though we haven't advertised or anything.
Absolutely.
Can you talk to our senior center director? And she will have, I'm sure, a list
I'm sure
of
she will. Most we work yeah. actually. Brian can go into this in a lot more detail, but we work very closely with all the senior programs. Actually, Brian, when my I've been with the agency since October.
Okay.
And one of the first meetings I had with one of the communities, it was a community development block grant meeting. The director of the senior center in Shelburne came up to me and went on and on about how important the housing rehab program was for her, for the members of her senior center.
Right. Right. We work closely with the councils on aging, on senior center, staff, boards of health, building departments. We get a lot of calls and inquiries from residents who've contacted those, you know, particular agencies or boards. And if we don't have money in the town, we put them on a waiting list and hope that, you know, at some point we'll be able to apply for funding to address the people on those on the waiting list. But also we would do marketing as part of, you know, if a grant was to go forward, if you wanted to go forward with this grant, then we certainly would contact.
Well, we have a list of people that are we're worried about.
Okay.
And okay.
So it would be lovely.
That would be very helpful.
Yes.
You know, consult our senior center director and
we couldn't reach out to them, but we could certainly make them part of a mailing list.
But we want to make sure they're on the list.
We would encourage you to have them reach out to us before we submit the application. So because one of the things we need to build is to show the need in the community.
Right.
And that would be very helpful.
Trevor is our point person for the senior center. And so
we'd be very excited to work
yeah.
with
Yeah. Because what it is, Trevor, is like windows and
so what I'm
you know, insulation,
steps, that kind of thing.
Steps.
So
you
is
know,
that
anything
like,
that it keeps people in their house safer.
If a building inspector or something finds faulty stairs to a woman's house or something like that, and she doesn't have the money to fund it, is this kind of where she would go to
Absolutely.
Say,
right.
how do I get help to make my
right.
Right.
There is income eligibility. There's some eligibility
sure.
requirements.
We have people that are just Social Security.
Yes, that need.
Right. That so they're likely to,
yeah.
to qualify.
Definitely. Great.
So,
yeah.
So I'd love
it would, as Fran was saying, it strengthens our application the more people that we have
on that list.
Just so long as we can show that we can meet the needs of, you know.
Well, right. we haven't done it for a couple of years, so we have a built
a backlog,
up.
Backlog, probably.
Yeah, yes. we do. We
the
have
last
a built
one
up need.
Was 2012 was
I noticed
the last
that.
Time we went through, and
yep.
There were six, information is, six people went through the program then. No, eight people. There were eight.
Yeah. Well, I know it's very helpful and it's very needful, so. Thank you very much. We certainly want to participate. Do you want us to vote on it officially or just send you a letter, or how do you want us to acknowledge that we want to participate?
If they want to vote tonight.
If you want to vote tonight, that would be absolutely wonderful, because one of the things that I have been learning so quickly.
Well, I just want to make sure that there's no holdup, because we don't meet for another
and
2 weeks.
We're actually behind... behind the curve on this. We really need you, if you could vote, and then we could start working with whoever you make the point staff person to work with us. We'll have to start working with them, because we'll start needing to have public meetings, posting the public meetings.
Oh, well,
and
Doug
that.
Would do that.
Right.
Yep.
But Trevor is our select board point person with
Perfect.
The senior. So
if I could just, before you to take a vote, if it's okay.
Sure.
I just thought, do you have a question?
Yeah.
Sorry.
People who apply for these, if they're eligible, is it free to them, or is there like a matching grant? Is there any matching portions from the community as far as that?
No, there isn't. It's not free per se. It's that we the programs that we've run since the early 80s are they're 0% no, you know, 0% interest loans, deferred payment, meaning that they get paid back. The loans get paid back when the house transfers ownership to another, whether it's a
estate that pays or something like that.
Yeah, so it gets recorded as a lien or a mortgage against the property. Mm-hmm. So there's no money going out the door on a monthly basis, but it will get paid back when it sells, you know, when it transfers ownership. There's different, you may be alluding to that. We have different funding mechanisms. Recently, we've had this, the way that it's been set up is that half the loan goes away over the course of 15 years.
Right. Okay, so. I think that's the one we participated in before.
Yes, in 2012.
And that's the one we like because it is sort of a forgiveness.
Exactly.
Right, yeah. Exactly. But that that money does eventually come back to the town. When it gets paid back, it goes into a revolving loan fund, which where, you know, you have an agreement from 2012 that that keeps getting renewed every year. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you're aware of that, but money goes into that account, and we're able to tap into that fund to reloan to people who come forward when we're not in a grant cycle year.
Sure. I remember that hoopla to try to sign off on that.
Yeah.
Remember, that was quite a big deal. Okay.
So is he saying that we currently have funds?
It circulates when they pay off if someone sells their house.
Right now you do have, there's a small amount. There's like $13,000. So we've used that, and that fund, we've tapped into that fund. And there, you get a statement. There's a yearly statement that you get on that. But I just wondered if we wanted to talk about any social service stuff also for any grant.
Right. Part of the grant will be some social service programs, as I discussed before. The community, we work closely with Community Action, and we provide a fuel assistance program.
Excellent.
That gets funded through the CDBG grant. And what we would do is, you don't have to identify what program you want to make part of the application tonight, but to make the application as strong as possible, we would recommend that you identify a social service program. In your 2012 application, you did participate in having Community Action, setting some funds aside for Community Action to fund a fuel assistance program.
Mm-hmm. And I think that's what we probably want to do again.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Would that be okay with you, Kip?
Sounds great.
All right. Okay. I make a motion that we participate in the Community Development Block Grant, and that we set some funding aside for Community Action fuel assistance program.
And rehab.
Okay.
Our second motion.
For Community Action.
Fuel assistance
programs. Okay.
Yeah. We don't need to identify anything more specific. Okay.
No.
Is there any further discussion?
No.
Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. John, yes.
I just wanted to bring up a related issue while you guys are here with you.
Sure.
Yeah, absolutely.
As sort of from the point of the planning board, I'm John Wade from the planning board.
Yes.
We did the housing production plan. And we started talking about affordable housing. And there's been a lot of attention to senior housing, so this is great. Mm-hmm. But I wanted to also just kind of see what the next steps are for other types of affordable housing. We have the CPA money that is directed to that. We talk about that like occasionally, but I think it's something that the planning board can't take on ourselves.
No,
you guys are already involved.
Well, we can't really say too much at this point, John, because we're hoping to hear something in the next 3 or 4 months. But what we're trying to do is, we will be using CPA funding towards senior housing needs and community needs, hopefully.
And is there a role for the regional housing authority?
I'm sure there will be. We don't have any definitive plans yet because we can't get committed.
I would just,
but we want to work with you, and we have Braeburn property that is still available. However, that wasn't what we were going to be discussing with you, probably towards November-ish.
That's terrific.
We will be in touch between around November, I think.
Okay. The only thing, if you don't mind, the only thing I would ask is if there's any, keeping in mind that the Regional Housing Authority currently manages over 100 units of senior housing, and Rural Development Inc., our 501c3 nonprofit, has developed over 130 units of affordable housing. If there's any way we can be of assistance to you as far as providing technical assistance or bring together the right expertise to the table.
I guess, is there any pots of money that are available for senior housing right now?
The state has these annual application cycles where you would be, we if you work together to put an application into the State Department of Housing and Community Development through what's called the one-stop application. The state is able to fund senior housing. There's lots of different types of senior housing projects out there.
Okay, because we have attempted since 1999.
But you haven't actually filed an application with the state.
No, because we've always worked through the Housing Authority. I think the Housing Authority has done it for us.
I went through all of the.
Okay, maybe so then we should probably have a new, separate. Is this a new procedure or?
No.
Okay.
They did feasibility studies for you. We never actually submitted an application for funding for you.
Oh. That's news.
You could probably get information about that.
I can provide you with the plans and everything that came out of the feasibility study.
That'd be great.
We have architectural renderings, all sorts of things it was never taken to the next step to submit applications for funding.
Would you make recommendations on what funding we would try to go for?
Absolutely.
So you could get back to us on
that?
Well,
Fran, this is very enlightening.
Isn't there a big piece missing? I mean, they could apply for the loans, but you still would need a developer or something to get involved.
We are the developer.
They are the developer.
You are the developers.
Yes.
So you take on...
We take on the role of developer.
They take on everything.
Our nonprofit development arm, Rural Development Inc., is a nonprofit developer, and we've done lots of different projects.
We got a lot of stuff when Paul Douglas was in your position, and then sort of dribbled away. So I would be very interested to restart this process again.
Yeah, please.
We were under the assumption, because we had tried so hard, that...
You took it to step one, but there's many steps that need to come after that, and we need to sit down, look at what was done in 2013, and then make a determination of what next steps would be feasible.
Well, we absolutely want to do that.
Can we set up a meeting to do that?
And that's separate from
absolutely
what we are also discussing just now.
Yeah.
So
correct.
We would certainly want to pursue that.
So, I will look forward to working with.
Do you want us to come over and meet with you?
I mean, that would be fantastic.
In the past, what we do is we go drive over and start working on the paperwork. If you want, we can start doing that.
I think we should just start with a meeting, go through what was done in 2012 and 2013,
mm-hmm.
and then determine what are feasible next steps.
Okay.
Trevor, we'll work it around your schedule.
Great.
And try to get something together in the next month or two then.
That's great.
I'd love to help with that.
Okay.
Did John?
The other thing I had was about when we were looking at the percentage of affordable housing, certified or written about affordable housing, it was very small in Deerfield. And a big chunk of them were over on Elm Circle, and they were going to be coming out of that. Has anybody looked into that? Do you know where that's going?
The problem is landlords have to sign up for indeed, and even though we have affordable apartments in town, a lot of landlords are not interested in.
So my question is, has the town made any encouragement to that, and is that something the Housing Authority can also help with? Because
yes.
I feel like the town isn't as proactive, and I don't. That's fine, but that's what they specialize in. They can help us.
Well, I certainly would. I think it's
because
would be good to pursue.
Pursue
renewing what we already have,
yes.
For sure.
Right. I think that's absolutely.
We're way below our 10%. I think we have less than 1% now.
Yeah. Which is one of the reasons you're in a CDF2 grant as opposed to a CDF.
Then we're below 1%.
I know. Well, we are below 1%, I think. But
so my question is, anybody talking to that developer?
No.
The landlords, no.
No.
And is that something that we should be doing?
Well, my first question is going to be, where is the inventory of affordable housing kept? Who has that? Does anybody know?
We had those housing meetings a year ago or two.
At least a couple years ago.
I think it's the assessors have that. I mean, where did we get that information? It's known information, but...
Yeah.
So, I don't know.
Maybe we might need to go back to square one and start with an inventory.
It does exist.
And it says when they come off of...
Yes.
They're like books for 10 or 15 or 20, they all have different...
After that, they're able...
The affordability deed restrictions are generally, the affordability deed restrict, that's information that's kept actually in the registry of deeds, but it's also kept, there's several different state and quasi-state agencies that keep that type of information.
We have a list.
And I'm sure at some point that was put together. That's something I can start researching for you and see if it's something that we actually kept as part of our feasibility study back.
And that would be wonderful if you could pursue.
I'm happy to do that.
I mean, as long as that's all right with you guys.
Because they would know if there's a deed restriction, because there would be a...
There's going to be an abatement on their tax bill as well.
Generally, there is.
So it's likely that might be a good place to start.
Yep, absolutely.
We do have a list somewhere. I mean, yeah.
Right. So we'll start working on that.
Okay.
Great.
All right. Any other questions?
No. Brian, you said you were recycling that small amount that we had come back in. Mm-hmm. Is that going off the waiting list, taking care of the people on the waiting list in general, or how are
Can we use that money to address the people that are on the waiting list right now?
No, I just wondered how you were picking how to recycle it, because we haven't done anything for a while.
Right.
I know it's a small amount of money.
Last year, well, actually, I think it was the year before, we used up almost all of the money, piggybacking that with, oftentimes what happens is that when you have a grant going, like the 2012 grant probably closed in 2015, actually, let's say. So we'll piggyback the money you have in your revolving loan fund with the grant money and sort of extend it. I believe that in the 2012 grant, our unit goal was 4 in Deerfield. It might have been 6. I can't really, don't hold me to that. We ended up doing 8 because we were able to tap into some of that revolving loan money and just continue the program. So these people, the people that were on the list, or who had qualified within that FY12 grant, also some of them, used up some of that money. So we got to a point, there's $13,000. Honestly, that's not a lot of money. So we keep that as a reserve. There's oftentimes when we'll have that small amount of money and somebody will call, someone from the Board of Health will call or whatever, there's a failed septic system, or someone from the senior center calls and says, so-and-so doesn't have any heat, So sometimes that money is sort of reserved for an emergency case.
That's fine.
People go to the top of the list sort of in those emergency cases.
And that's all I was interested in, just to make sure that we were trying to hit the people that we know we have some that have issues and are needful.
Do we have your contact so I could maybe get in touch with you at some point?
I will
point,
get you a card.
That'd be great. That'd be great.
Full contact information.
That'd be great.
All right. They're over my purse.
She'll give you one.
All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I really appreciate you taking the initiative to come back to us. I'm very excited about the senior housing stuff.
Oh.
Because we had been told there was no money for...
We're excited to work with you.
That'd be great.
Thank you.
Great.
It really is a pleasure. Thank you.
Wow. That's so much better.
I didn't seem to get any minutes.
No, I didn't have any minutes either.
Thank you.
Minutes for us?
I do not have the minutes from the 12th prepared. I apologize for that.
Nope, that's okay.
I'll be ready for the next meeting.
Then we'll just go down to Kevin. Let's take care of you because you're here.
Sweet.
I don't want to make you have to wait.
Good evening. How are you tonight?
Good.
Actually, in a really good mood. What a nice person compared to who was there before. I probably shouldn't say that, but. Wow, someone that wants to work with us. That's very exciting.
That's wonderful news.
Yes. Mm-hmm. After being cranky for 17 years. Isn't that gross? That's how long it's been. Okay.
All right.
Okay, basically what we're here for this evening is I've already gone in front of personnel board. What it is our mechanic, he was a grade level 2, and doing a little bit of research into our compensation plan, because historically in the past, the mechanic has always been paid a little bit more than the standard truck drivers. Because you think about it, a person that comes in as a truck driver laborer, granted they have a Class B CDL and they have at least some of their hydraulics licenses. And obviously there's a skill level that comes along with that. Mm-hmm. But the mechanic, his position for what he has to do is much greater depth. His information has to be more, besides the fact, and this is besides the fact, because it really doesn't pertain to this, but he does have $150,000 worth of his own tools that he has brought to the town to utilize those, because quite honestly, the tool selection that we have is extremely bleak.
Right.
So basically what I ended up doing is I went back through and I started looking at the classification plan, and there's a point depending on which factors come into play. You know, and your factors are your education, your experience, your accountability, judgment, supervision required, nature, so on and so forth, work environment. And I was looking at his numbers, and his numbers were the same as an equipment operator. And once again, you know, looking at the knowledge that has to be more to be able to work on all of our heavy equipment, you know, our hydraulics, and going through the compensation plan, I went through and I re-looked at exactly how the whole thing was set up, and redid his point average, and his point average went up to a grade 3. Mm-hmm. Presently right now, my old position, which has been vacated again, was a grade 3 foreman facilities manager. So talking with Chuck and talking with personnel, what we've done is changed up the job description slightly to the point of calling it a maintenance foreman heavy equipment operator. So basically what Chuck is going to be doing this position would be overseeing the building maintenance and would obviously still be doing the maintenance on all of our vehicles, and then obviously when he has time in between, you know, snowstorms, whole nine yards, he still goes out and provides our snowplow,
bucket
and,
loader,
and sanding and salt. Salting. So, what I kind of thought about, to be fair to the town and trying to be fiscally responsible, again with staying within my own realm of not changing up my budget whatsoever, it's very easy to go ahead and take this position, change that to a grade 3 position, and if this passes, then I would like to have permission to go ahead and put out a equipment operator position, which would be a grade 2, which is basically, we're almost like making a quick little switch in between. So that way I'm not really asking for two grade 3 positions, you know, which I didn't think was fair to the town. But be honest with you, the person I do bring in for my equipment operator, I would really like them to have some basic handyman, you know, change light bulbs, you know, very simple things like that to be able to help Chuck out a little bit, or that position. So realistically, that's what I'm really looking for, to be able to bring the position from a grade 2 to a grade 3. And
expand the capabilities of that person a little bit.
I'm sorry?
Expand the capabilities of
that
position
correct.
A little
yes,
bit.
Correct.
The only question I had, Kevin,
yep.
is, because I think it's a good idea, mm-hmm. My only concern was that we're really trying to get on top of facilities management, so mm-hmm. would you still be sort of overseeing the facilities?
Oh, of course. I obviously still oversee everything as it goes along. And to be honest with you, I'm going to help out as needed. I mean, because that's me.
Okay.
That's my position.
By no means am I just going to be
saying, okay, here you go, buddy. It's all yours, and then turn around and walk away.
I know. No. But, you know, we haven't been doing as much as we should in the past.
Oh, certainly.
And we're trying to get on top of it.
Exactly.
So I kind of didn't want that to disappear. That was my only concern.
Yeah, no, definitely. We're still going to be staying on top. Actually, if anything, it's probably going to be increased more, because realistically, it's been me.
I know.
And trying to do all the things in my standard job, and then still try and come in and try and look at some different things here and there, and you know, again, like the senior center flooring and stuff like that. You know, all those things that position would be taken care of in the future.
I could reach out to him, and he could he can go out for bids, you know, and
which
all that.
We'll talk about that one after.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Do we have I'm not familiar enough with this to understand all the grade 3, grade 2, and stuff like that. Do you have a scale of showing the pay rates, or do you have that in front of you where you could
No, I don't have that in front of me, but Doug has that.
Are you asking about the classification?
Yeah, what's the difference, like, you know, if he wants to change this position to a grade level 3?
Well,
what was it and where's it going to?
It depends on the step.
Are you talking about the monies?
Yeah.
Okay. Kevin, do you have that?
I'm digging.
I could probably dig it up as well. The difference between a grade 2 and a grade 3, broadly speaking, is about a buck to a buck and a half an hour on each end of the scale, maybe a little bit more on the high end. It's a slight shift. I think grade 2 has a top pay of $21 or $22. Grade 3 has a top pay of $24 or something along those lines.
It's not a huge amount, but it depends on the step. Where the person enters the step in the grade is going to give you the biggest difference in money, not necessarily the grade.
Okay.
Because there's a huge amount of overlap, but you
have
the
ability. That's why I didn't know, you know.
Because you have the ability to have a little bit more. It might only be a dollar, but 50, but there should be a little bit more than that. I don't know. Kevin has it.
Excuse me, my chair is scratched all over. This has been my working copy.
No, that's fine.
Does it have the pay rate on?
Thank you.
Yeah, perfect.
Yeah, see the step is what?
So presently right now.
See these steps, where are you going to?
If you look down.
Grade level 3, okay.
The very last one underneath grade level 2 is heavy equipment operator.
Yep.
Is mechanic heavy equipment operator. Presently right now he is at a step 10, which is 2163.
Okay.
Talking with personnel. They were asking me at that point in time, what would I be looking for a pay scale at that point in time? So going to a grade 3, 2163 is a grade 7, excuse me, is a step 7. I requested that it go to a step 8, which is 2244.
Okay.
Which gives him basically two more years after this year. After this fiscal year, so fiscally FY 2020, he would be considered over, which is basically just a COLA adjustment, which historically in the past has been about 1.7%.
Yeah, okay.
You lost me with that couple of extra years.
I'm sorry.
Because you're a great year, step 7 versus a 9 or a 10. And once you get 10, you're maxed out. Whereas, if you start 7, you can go up.
So does it change every single year?
This has not changed in 8 years.
Okay. So
actually, if you bring somebody in at a grade, at a step 1, you started somebody 8 years ago.
Right.
Whereas here he's already.
That's something that we deal with in the future, though.
Yes. Well, that's why we're supposed to be doing the comp study.
Comp study, yep.
Every 2 years.
Yep.
Because people get stuck at 10.
Yeah.
But then he would.
And the other side of the coin is when it comes to looking at the comp study, excuse me, it also is fair to try and bring new people in. The simple fact is, like I said, if you go ahead, say, like you go out with a grade level 1, step 1, that's $12.02 an hour 8 years ago.
I know.
And cost of living has gone up dramatically, as far as I'm concerned, in the past 8 years.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's why we're supposed to adjust. That's why we're doing the comp study.
Correct.
Yep. Mm-hmm. So you can adjust, because some of these do change.
Sure, certainly.
And some of them won't. But, okay.
And I do know at this point, just to kind of go a little bit further, just to let you know, when it comes to trying to find an equipment operator, town of Northfield so far right now, 2.5 months.
Looking
for an equipment operator.
With not much luck. He did end up getting one. He's looking for two.
Do you know about where they're paying? They're paying grades or anything?
Anywhere between 18 and 20 bucks an hour. Wow. And they're not finding anybody to start.
Wow.
Same thing over in Sunderland right now. Sunderland, he's been looking for approximately 6 weeks.
Yeah.
And he has a few
possibles
that have applied. I'll just leave it at that.
Yeah.
That is, that amount is pretty much an industry standard anyways. The thing is, it's just a shortage of licensed equipment operators.
Right.
That's for what it takes to keep up your licenses,
right.
And
it's
stuff.
Everywhere, you know. But I think one of the benefits, you know, I'm not job looking, but, you know, usually municipalities are a good deal. Not that they pay a lot more, but they definitely don't pay less. But their benefits
are good.
Is tremendous to what a lot of, you know, private companies, you know, offer. So, yeah, especially in the beginning, you know.
Oh, exactly.
You know, a lot of times when you start out new in a company, you might get 2 weeks vacation, but you don't get a lot of the other things, you know, only whatever's, you know, mandatory.
Kevin, this might be stretching your mind a little bit. If you recall, several months ago, the town interviewed several people for a foreman's position, one that eventually went to K3.
That's correct.
One of the individuals who applied for that, who ultimately decided and was offered the position and ultimately decided against it, was a young man who worked for the UMass.
That's correct.
And he was a basic equipment operator there, driving either payloaders or dump trucks or what have you.
Correct.
I believe his reasoning, do you remember his reason for not taking the foreman's position?
Yeah, basically it was to save money with so much more responsibility. And he was a little bit sketchy about the facilities end of it. He says it was a standard foreman's position with not dealing with the facilities. He said he might think about it
because
it's a little bit closer to home for him.
Sure.
And obviously he can take his time from UMass and turn it into county retirement.
Right.
So he wouldn't be losing anything there. But
in that case, as an equipment operator only,
right,
he was making even money with the foreman's rate.
Correct.
Which
we were offering $21.83 at that point in time.
Right.
You know, because you think about what it costs to go ahead and get your license. You know, presently right now, you know, you go through for your driver's license, your Class B CDL. You can guarantee you that you're not going to pass the first time.
Oh, sure.
And again, this is just me speaking personally, not as a town person, mm-hmm. but I think it's a way of them to generate more cash.
Because
it seems like anybody I've talked to over the years have never passed the first time. They've always found one little thing that was wrong. Like in the book, when you go for your air test or the air brake endorsement part of it, if you don't read it exactly word for word the way that is written in the book, you fail. You can take one word and change it in front of each other, but it's not exactly how the guy wants to hear it. And I've also heard stories, and again, fourth, fifth, sixth hand information, you read it as a book and they still don't like it. And 90% of the time, that's where people are failing their tests, is the air brake endorsements. Because they're not just liking the way that, well, you know, I'm building up my air is supposed to build up within this set amount of time, you know, and I shut the machine down. My bleed down time is this, I put my foot on the brake, this is how much it's supposed to come down, blah, 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 blah. And if you don't give everything exactly to the T, exactly where it needs to be, they don't pass. So we end up having an employee that tried going a few times and he wasn't able to get it. So he ended up going and spending $300 out of his pocket to go down to a tractor trailer training school. He had an hour on the course and then the inspector came down and did the test and he had no problems there. So you take that in consideration. Then you go ahead and you take your hydraulics licenses. You know, and the hydraulics licenses aren't cheap by any means. You know, right now I've got a 1B, 2A, 3A, 4A. And for each one of those, you have to have 4 hours of continuing education every 2 years at $200 a whack.
Do you pay that out of your own pocket? Or is it
the majority of this gets paid out of our own pocket. Some of this is we have been getting reimbursed, but not 100%. You know, every year I have to go because I've had blood pressure. So every year I have to go for my physical. That's $65 every year. So,
broadly speaking, if an employee in your department does not maintain his licenses for whatever reason or other, he can't continue to do the work.
That's correct.
So he's required to maintain these licenses.
Correct.
Out of his own pocket.
Yep. And again, some of these, we've been helping out a little bit here and there, but we've never been across the boards as far as helping out 100%. And you think about it, if we bring somebody in as a grade two step one, that's $14.42 an hour for all of those licenses that are required. So it makes it a little bit difficult for somebody to come in as a step one. So if I get past this step, I will have to go back to personnel, because that is part of our bylaw, that I would have to request that I have the ability to go above step one when we do try and make an offer to an applicant.
For an equipment operator.
For an equipment operator.
That's legit, because we have to compete.
Yep.
So, okay. So you want a motion for us to approve this?
Please.
Okay. Do you have any other questions, Kip?
Nope. I'm good.
No, I feel good.
Okay.
Make a motion to approve the maintenance foreman heavy equipment operator as listed in the job description.
For grade level three.
Grade level three.
I second the motion.
Is there any further discussion?
Nope.
Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, Kevin.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Can I twist on you for just like three more
sure.
seconds?
Yep. Oh, of course.
Actually, before he does, let me just clarify.
Thank you.
You approve the job description of the maintenance foreman, heavy equipment operator. That's actually a modification of what used to be mechanic / heavy equipment operator.
Right.
Correct.
And it's
correct.
At grade three.
Right. At grade three. This is not a creation of a new position, but a modification of an existing position.
Yes.
Correct.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you.
So what's the scoop?
Okay. Thank you. Basically, I'm going to say probably 3 weeks or a month ago, my understanding is you guys were curious about the Franklin County Solid Waste Management District contract that historically we've signed an MOU with them. For them, for basically what they end up doing is, you know, they go ahead, they look at all, reviewing all the hauling invoices, they check it for accuracy, they check it against each load, and obviously if there's any light loads, they go ahead, they get in touch with me and let me know it's a light load. They ensure that the tandem hauls are used when legally possible. The only ones they really can't do is the trash, because of the GVWs in the state of Massachusetts. They're not allowed to go through. Monitors the pricing of the scrap metal revenue. Recently negotiated the elimination of, because in the past, when every time we got rid of a mattress, it cost us an extra $25. Because of what they did for us, or actually for the entire district, now there's no cost to us whatsoever per mattress.
Perfect.
And then obviously all the problems and issues that are corrected, they take care of it. And it's
so, Kevin, if there's no charge for the mattresses for us,
yep.
can we make no charge for our citizens so they don't end up on the side of the road?
Sure, we can.
Just
remember, we're still paying weight, though.
Oh. Mm. Well, maybe we could reduce it just a dash.
Sure.
Make it more attractive. Okay. I just...
What is...
Because we are picking up, it's about $30 a mattress.
So make it 20 if you could.
Yeah. Figure out some number and just reduce it a little bit. Only because, I mean, we want to cover our weight, but
right.
Mattresses and refrigerators are real issues on
and
the
TVs.
Side of the road. And TVs on the side of the road.
A lot of TVs on the side of the road.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
So if we can figure out some way to manage that, that would be wonderful.
That'd be great. So with all those things, basically that's what they end up doing. And if you look across the top, going from FY14 backwards, 15, 16, you can see what the original costs were. You know, it was $63,009, then it was $58,000, now it's $53,000. The bulky item, again, 14, 15, 16, went 18, 18, down to 13. The metal went up for the simple fact that we ended up getting a tad bit more revenue on that. The recycling, again, the prices on that went down. And then when it came to the fuel credits, because they were able to deal with multiple agencies in the haulers, they were able to reduce our credits for our fuel credits. From 2014, our fuel credits were $617. Now it's $2,600. Metal revenue, unfortunately, because the cost of steel has gone down, you know, scrap's not as good as it was, you know, unfortunately that one has gone down. But again, the costs, again, before was, you know, 1,080, 810, and then 250 for our mattresses, what was historically in the past. So I would like to see if you would entertain the idea of signing the MOU contract with Franklin County Solid Waste Management District for FY17.
So these are just these are what it costs us, or these are what we got back for
the tops are the savings.
Okay. Yep.
The tops are the different costs as it's gone down, the savings in the past.
Mm-hmm.
And then the lower ones are the actual savings. That's the credits that have come back to us.
We got for metal, we got
exactly. That's why there's like a separation between the two.
But basically, you're saying for 2016, we paid $87,000 to the Franklin County
for trash, bulky metal, right, and recycling. Not to them. This is what basically ended up costing us.
Well, who do we pay that money to then? When you say it costs,
we call them to the haulers, to the trash. To we do get a little bit of a credit back, but we still end up paying so much per ton for all of our recycling that goes down to the Murph in Springfield.
Yeah. So totally to all the vendors, we pay $87,000
roughly.
And what do we generate in dump bags and
That I can't tell you off the top of my head. Dump bags,
I believe it's more than that, or run, actually I believe it's right about that.
Let me put it this way. I think the probably easiest way of saying this is between what we receive in and between stickers, bags, and bulky item, for the most part washes what we owe.
Mm-hmm.
Minus, and I want to, and correct me if I'm wrong on this one, but I want to say it was pretty much salaries was the only difference.
If you don't include the test well monitoring.
Oh, yeah, can't include the test well.
And you don't include salaries.
Completely separate.
Transfer station costs are a wash.
So,
yeah. We used to subsidize about $150,000, and every year we've chipped away at it.
Yep.
I mean, this has been a real focus because we shouldn't be subsidizing it. And we are getting down.
I had a question a little bit about how that runs up there. I noticed we're not taking cash anymore. It's just checks.
August, that was two of my.
Oh, you got some.
Little,
you got
two of my little things. Oh, okay. I like to make an announcement of.
Well, that and I was curious. One the reason for that, it's hard. You know, not everybody brings a checkbook with them. So I was wondering, would there be an idea? This is just throwing darts here, should we charge more for bags and forget the stickers if stickers are such a hassle to, you know, one for our guys aren't, you know, we have to pay, guys got to monitor who's coming in with a thing. It's kind of a pain.
Right.
And I was so fortunate that they were actually taking money for stickers up there, and I'm in town all the time.
Right.
And I never bring my checkbook. I hardly ever write checks. It's always a credit card and never have cash. I'm broke. So it's just difficult for people, you know. So I'm just wondering, is that something to look at in the future?
That's something we discussed.
Yep.
It's actually what really kind of brought this whole cash thing and checks about is Brenda said she was showing great concern about this because we're handling cash.
Right.
These guys are not bonded.
Correct.
There's no cash register up there. They hand out receipts when people request them, but other than that,
mostly it's just.
And the auditors did not catch it.
Right.
And they're extremely concerned that probably after I just said this, they're going to catch it next year.
They're going to want. They're going to want some.
And that's going to be an issue.
As we asked.
Well, I need to just make sure that it is very clear that there has been no accusations, speculation that anyone's doing anything wrong.
Of course not.
This has been simply to try to improve the way the town handles cash
money
across the board.
Correct.
We're looking at the transfer station. We're also looking at the way cash is handled in the inspections office, in the town administrator's office, two other places where money comes in and goes out.
Mm-hmm.
And we're looking at improving our processes in order to secure the funds of the town. This is nothing to do.
No, not at
with
all.
With the folks
nothing
at the transfer station or the job they're the doing.
Correct.
I want to make sure that's very clear.
No, yes, definitely.
That's kind of interesting that the auditors haven't picked up on that, because I'm sure they would.
Like we talked about with the, you know, the
Tri-Town Beach, yes.
So,
I mean, usually
we would have
they
have a process. And I
was going to say, since I don't go, I don't really know. What does it cost for a sticker annually?
$65.
$65. And how much does it cost for a bag?
$20 for a...
$25.
$25.
It's $2.50 a bag.
$2.50 a bag.
See, it's supposed to be, to me, it's very important that it be user fee. So if you have a lot of trash,
sure,
you need to pay for it.
Mm-hmm.
But I think one of the reasons we had stickers, why the whole sticker came, is because we had out-of-town people using it. And there is a cost. I mean, when we had landfills, I mean, it was just...
But now that it's just transfer, I'm wondering if people want to buy our bags and it covers our cost, if we have to say... You know, I don't know. I don't know what the rate would be. Maybe there's a rate for seniors versus...
Pretty dramatically.
Well, I mean, we're still...
I think people are going to kind of freak out a little bit when all of a sudden, what do you mean it's $8 a bag?
Right.
Yeah.
You know?
Right. No, we'd have to bring it, you know, it can't be too much more, but if they don't have to pay a...
If you did, thinking about it, you know, if you've got a single person in a household and you increase the cost of the bag to X dollars, whatever, but eliminated the cost of the sticker... I think, broadly speaking, maybe I'm just speculating, but I think we'd still want a sticker to prove residency. So folks still have to come to town hall, present their registration. They get a sticker, but they get it for free. Now the bags cost a little bit more. But if I'm a single person generating, I might have one bag of trash every second or third week.
But it's the, you know, it's the hassle of dealing with the sticker here.
Right.
Getting the sticker, our men... monitoring,
making sure
it,
the people
having the
have
police
the stickers,
officer there for a couple weekends. It's a pain.
And then they're not getting difficult.
You know, they feel like they're not getting paid to do that, to monitor. So if we, you know, if there was a way around it so we didn't have to monitor that.
Well,
but we still covered our costs.
How
people
many
have to cover
stickers we sell in a year?
Yes, it's all in our budget. But you know what?
We can provide
this is something
we should look at it for the future.
I was just going to say, let's look at it.
For FY18.
In the next
budget
process.
We're not doing anything
maybe,
now. But,
maybe because we have gotten to the point where we're kind of in the area of a wash. Maybe we can do something of just... I mean, the sticker usage when we really... I mean, for a while there it was awful. And we had a fine if you didn't get the sticker.
Sure.
It really... We did get up our numbers of stickers. So there's a lot less violation. My concern is just, you know... It does cost us ultimately because you're not paying for salaries. You're not paying for. I mean, it is a part-time job, so we are not paying the benefit package. But there are related costs, and
we want to cover.
So
those.
You should be covering those costs as much as possible.
If
you sell the bags like at Leader Home Center, and someone's coming from out of town, they're therefore enjoying the convenience of our transfer station. But maybe.
But an
I'm
idea is if you raise the price of the bag by a dollar, but eliminated the cost of the sticker.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm just picking round
That's
numbers here.
Too.
If you used four bags a week, you know.
Right. And I usually use two for a household of three.
Yeah, so that's an extra
cycling off.
One or two.
I was just going to say, how come you use so much? My goodness.
I was going to say, I got four in my house, and I got a bag every 2 weeks.
Is that right?
Yeah. Everything else is recycled.
No, we throw away a bunch of junk. And I recycle pretty good. I throw away all the paper. I throw away all my metal. I'm picking cans out of the trash.
Throwing it away, you recycle it.
I recycle.
You know, my only concern is like I'm a bag a week person.
Mm-hmm.
So
only
if I
one?
Pay if I yeah if I pay the $65 and then I use, you know, a bag a week of 52 bags, I'm you're paying more. I mean, I don't.
No, because if you paid $3 a bag without a sticker, you're paying about the same money.
Well, maybe. It's just that
again, this is something we can look into.
We can look into
We can start looking at different.
I just want to lessen the guys' work up there and people monitoring and all. If we can just say, hey, you got a bag, throw it away.
Yeah.
It might save on cash handling up there, checks. I mean, and you still have bulky stuff.
But then again,
think
the other side is just keep in the back of your mind that sticker helps offset the costs of our recycling, too.
Sure.
So.
Okay. Something to think about.
So otherwise, then you mean just having people just start rolling in that don't have any. Just
right,
start,
I see
you know
what you
mean.
They're not throwing trash, but they're doing the recycles,
right,
and they're getting that for free.
Only. So then now we're going to end up having more of a cost to the town that we're going to end up having to absorb. So there's just a few things.
There are.
There's a lot of things we need to look at.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you know, that thought has never been put forth. The reason why, again, that was put to me was let's go to checks because most all the other towns, checks only. You go to Greenfield, check only. You go to Berniston, check only.
Yep,
that's true. And I am surprised the auditors haven't said anything, but Maybe they just missed it.
Well, I'm sure they will now.
Yeah, they're going to hear it. So we'll fix it for this year.
So two announcements to kind of go along with the transfer station is this weekend will be the last weekend. They'll be selling stickers at the transfer station. And then September 1st, we're still trying to institute the check only, no cash. Okay. We're attempting to do.
Okay.
So back to the MOU.
Do you have phone service up there?
I'm sorry?
Is there a telephone at the...
Yes, that is correct. Yeah, we do have a telephone.
Have you ever thought about taking credit cards?
Well, that's what my thought was, like, even on a cell, you know, one of those...
Little slides you put on a cell phone type deal?
Yeah, but don't you have to pay?
Maybe.
You do, but it's not much.
It's what, 2%?
It's 2%. 2 to 3%.
Everybody's got a debit card, so I never have cash.
Because I never carry cash.
If you want to look into it,
my wife has
I'll donate checkbook, credit so. Card machines.
Okay. Yeah. You can do that.
That'd be great.
Okay.
It's
going
to be stuff to look at. And then there was one other thing on that. I saw signs around town about electronic recycling maybe this weekend. Is it us
that,
or somewhere else?
With the church.
That's with the church.
Yeah,
okay.
That's correct.
Holy Family?
Yep.
We usually have one in the fall, right?
Okay.
Spring and fall.
All right.
Do you know the date of the...
I do not.
Okay.
Not off the top of my head, I don't.
All right.
Okay.
Well, we'll get the date. We'll put it on the website.
Yep.
Kevin, I feel like we haven't really discussed it enough. We'll do it in this next cycle.
Mm-hmm.
Anything
sure.
to adjust. So I make a motion that we approve the MOU with the Solid Waste District.
Mm-hmm.
I'll second it.
Okay. Is there any further discussion?
Nope.
Okay, hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, and then what we'll do is in this next budget cycle, we'll fiddle around with...
We'll start looking into it now.
Because we haven't done it for about a year or so. I mean, we just use the same rates from last year,
yep.
so...
Exactly. Yeah, we've been trying to keep the prices down about the same. As long as my basic opinion was is we're trying to keep it awash. You know,
yes.
We can keep it awash where, mm-hmm. where the rest of the town is not subsidizing the trash...
And that was the whole purpose behind it.
So
we want to keep it affordable for seniors.
Exactly.
And the only reason I was harassing you about the mattresses is because refrigerators, mattresses, TVs, they end on the side of the road, and then we end up having to use highway
to get rid of them.
Right, and highway people to pick them up, and so it would be just nice if we get encourage people to do it more.
No, in Sunderland they don't have a transfer station.
Nope.
So does town pay for that street pickup?
Nope.
The individual homeowners have to pay for it.
Strictly
just pick
private.
Up only. Is that right? Just pick up. They have like street side pickup.
Yeah, but you pay for it. It's you make a deal with
Amherst or
whoever.
Okay.
Or you do whatever you do with your trash.
Right.
So yeah, Sunderland, once they close their station, they said we're not dealing with trash anymore, we're not dealing with recycling anymore.
Wow.
It's all on you. Figure it out. It was another one of their cost cutting that they end up having to do because of their issues.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, there's another side to look at it. It's environmentally a lot more friendly to have curbside pickup than have 800 people driving to the dump with two bags of trash.
That's true.
Talk about greenhouse gases.
Yeah, you're right about that.
Well, I usually go during the week when
not,
I have a meeting.
As long as you're not so burning it out back.
But unfortunately, there's some people, because the curbside is expensive.
It is.
So if you're looking at a elderly person that generates one bag a month because they're by themselves, they're shelling out like 10 times more than what they
95.
Normally would do if they had trash going to someplace else.
It was
else.
A lot. I did it for a year, and that was that.
Always trying to think of, you know, the other people that, you know, the... lower income, seniors, whole nine yards. You know, you just try and make sure that
I know,
it's,
and we can look at the senior discount again because you know,
seniors obviously have a discount. They
we can see
the
if
stickers
we
are
can do a little
bit. Instead of
$65.
Well, I heard about that too. I had a senior ask me why she could not buy a sticker because she didn't have a car.
Her son puts it on her car, and her son takes her trash.
Yeah.
But
she says, how do I? She says, I went in to buy a sticker and they wouldn't sell me one because I don't have a registration.
That was not brought to my attention. Historically, anytime
well,
they have
town
issues,
hall, not you,
yeah.
But.
Historically, anytime they have issues here, usually Pat Raymer always called me right away and said, hey, I got something new here, check this one out, what do you want me to do? So, I mean, that particular instance right there. But, I mean, unfortunately, you also have people in town that are extremely cheap. All right, I'll buy the sticker, and you buy the bags, and I tell you what, hey, you go ahead and get a spare sticker for your car for $10, and I'll give you $20 for it. It's all over town. That's why they went to writing the license plate number on the sticker, because that's what people are doing. But now, once again, like you said, now not only do you look and see, okay, yeah, there's a brown sticker there, does that sticker match the plate?
Yeah, we don't need to be doing all that.
So these guys that are up there at $16 an hour.
Right. They shouldn't be maintaining
that. They've, especially on a Saturday, they've got their hands full.
They are busy up there.
That place is insane.
They work hard.
You know, they talked about different things, about putting in a shack. You know, we talked looking into, okay, well, we're going to change the traffic flow in there. You know, we're going to require everybody going to the right. There's going to be a little shack, and it's going to be like Greenfield. Say, okay, let's see, you got your three trash bags. That's great. You got other stuff on the back. That's $15.
Right there.
Or you don't go through the gate.
Yeah.
So,
Nowadays with electronics, all kinds of things. You can get a transponder, sell them a transponder for $50. You know, can be good for multiple years, and they just drive in, and if the little light doesn't go off because they don't have the transponder in the vehicle, they don't go in. And
it's possible.
Yeah.
All right. I can see we're going to have a good discussion.
Easy.
To answer your question from the other night, Trevor, I did go ahead and I reached out to two other places.
Oh, thank you.
And right now, because obviously the quotes that we got are too old.
Yeah. Yeah.
Mid-September is basically the closest I can get, is to be able to get in there. But there's other discussions we need to talk about realistically before we actually do the installation, because there's questions I have about the building and
what we do,
where we're going and how we're going. And I just hate to go ahead and spend some money on something and not utilize it properly.
Okay.
And then, I'm not trying to step on anybody's toes, but I just want to make an announcement that there's a sewer rate study presentation here next Tuesday, August 2nd at 6 p.m.
Right.
So those that are a sewer rate payer or a sewer user, this will be affecting you. So this is the presentation on the different avenues that we're going to be looking at to make our revenues match what we're putting out.
And what we need to do.
Are you guys going to be able to go?
Okay.
It's 6 p.m., right?
6 p.m. right here.
Okay.
Yep.
I have a meeting already, but maybe I can
We'll tape it.
No, as long as these guys go, then it's okay.
But because realistically, you're still going to need all the same information, too, because realistically, when it's all said and done, it's the three of you that actually set the rate.
Oh, okay. No, absolutely. So, that's why I wanted to make sure that someone was, or both of you guys would be able to go.
Yep.
Okay, thank you.
Is the broad understanding on the board that the sewer rate study, granted there will be the public presentation, but you do have a sewer study committee that has been looking at sewer and is going to be, that's part of one of the things that I think they're supposed to be looking at is how to pay for various things. Cool. Are you going to be referring that sewer rate study to the committee for a recommendation?
Yes.
Yeah, I would imagine.
That's what we're having this presentation for. The sewer study committee is going to meet next Tuesday, and the presentation is going to be to that committee, and the general public is invited. And we'll take the information that we get from that study, and we'll deliberate and put our own thoughts into it, and see what we come up with.
But that, just so you're aware, that can't be December 31st, 2018. That has to be before, mid-September? Because you guys have to reset the rates again.
Yes.
Okay.
Actually needs to be a priority for the sewer study committee.
To set a rate.
To provide a recommendation to the sewer.
When do you need that, Kevin? You need that by September?
Yeah, I want to say it was October 1st last year when we actually
how long
set the rate.
How long is that rate in effect?
For one year.
Oh, for 1 year.
Yeah.
Okay, so what's our first meeting in September, Doug, is what?
First meeting in September is going to be the September...
What is it, 7th?
7th, yes.
7th?
Yeah. Okay, why don't we put it on the agenda for the 7th? Do you think you would be able to come up with a recommendation by the 7th?
We can change it. The reason I say that, Carol, is because part of this is you know, not only, you know, setting the rate now, but, you know, what type of improvements and, you know, infrastructure,
right.
What are we going to be doing? So it's going to be more comprehensive than that. You know, just coming up with a rate for next year, I think, would be pretty simple.
Right.
But, you know, we're trying to, I think one of the things that we're going to look at is everything that's involved
capital
with it.
And
you know,
which
the, right. And that's what we're going to be looking at
well,
in the big picture.
Let's put it on for September 7th, and we can adjust it after that.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And I'm not trying to rush you. It's just
oh,
that,
no, I just was trying to explain.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't think coming up with a rate just for next year would be a problem
right.
at all. You know,
again, just, and I don't think this is a teaser or a spoiler or anything like that, but it's going to be more than simply a presentation that concludes with, here's the dollar amount you should charge.
Oh,
right.
It's going
right.
to be an entire presentation of
but
ideas.
But I just wanted to make sure that we just, in the,
right.
we don't lose it in the weeds.
No, fair
and
enough.
We,
and so it's not going to
I'll
be, my point though is that it's not going to be simply setting a rate.
Oh, no.
Right.
It may be establishing an entirely different mechanism by which rates are assessed.
Right. Yes.
And
so, Kevin, can we plan at this point, having you come September 7th so
sure.
we can discuss
yeah,
that?
No problem.
We can have a good discussion. Maybe it will get, you know, pushed down to the, like the 21st or something. But
yeah. No, like I said, I want to say it was like October 1st or something like that.
I know it's somewhere
year.
In
and
there.
What I'm trying to do is I'm
yeah.
trying to give you like a 30-day buffer, so that way if something happens, gives you a little extra time to think about it.
I mean, we can adjust the rates if we have to later on too. I mean, if we can't figure out the capital of business, we could set the first.
Right.
First set of rates.
Exactly. I mean,
and then say that we're going to add on the capital the second rate.
Because whether you go ahead and you change up the style of or the way that you go ahead and put the rates out, because presently right now, you know, it's by 1,000 gallons.
Mm-hmm.
Or it's divided, you know, take your thing and divide it by 1,000, and then it's by, what's 674 a gallon?
Six, yeah.
Or
yes. Per right. thousand.
Yeah, 674 per 1,000.
Yeah, 674 per 1,000. That's the way you got to figure it out right now. But if we stay with this, we're going to be out of money here right shortly.
Mm-hmm.
Because the monies that are coming in do not match the monies basically that are end up going out.
Right.
Well,
I know.
And that's really not including all of our capital
all
and stuff
the work
like that,
that needs to get done
on top of it.
Mm-hmm. Well, do we have to give a heads up that we're going to do an institutional rate?
Well, these are all the things that we're going to be talking about.
Okay.
You know,
yeah,
these are all your options. You know,
yep.
Are you going to do industrial? Are you going to do residential? Are you going to do institutional?
We are.
Are you going to do it by the building? Are you going to do it by the just device? Are you going to do it by the gallons? And that is what we paid this money for, this guy to come in and say, here's all your different options. This mm-hmm. is how it works. And this is how it can work for you. Because realistically, we need to build capital.
Yes.
You know, historically in the past, we were supposed to be, if hypothetically, if we did exactly what DEP told us to in 1971 and made the rates high enough to put the capital away, what we need to do, if we wanted to do everything that we wanted to do, here's a check, make it happen.
Right, we would have had the money.
The way
people
it stands right now, I have
$300,000.
So.
Has the
thing
sewer
is,
rate changed at all in the last few years?
It's gone up pennies.
Well, yeah, we've always what we've only done is just we did put a piece for the capital,
right.
And we put in it was like a 5% or something. It was a very small amount that we tacked on,
but
and that was relatively
stuff,
recent. That was new for me.
Failing.
I mean, that was since I was here.
Exactly. And like our
so
sludge
we
right
weren't
now,
doing anything before.
But yeah. our sludges.
That's going
to
kill us.
More than tripled.
Yeah.
Well, what was happening before is the town would just pay for it out of operations, you know, general municipal.
Yeah.
But then we separated the transfer station, we separated the sewer system,
right.
We separate, because all these things, I mean, we were subsidizing the transfer station like well over $150,000.
Wow.
When I was flipped out, I said, like, you know, you were making everybody pay for trash when.
Not
the user should be paying for trash.
Correct.
And so, anyway.
Yep. All right.
We're trying to organize these things, and it takes a while because some of this stuff is a shock. And so, but we're trying to fix things.
Well, that's, yeah. I mean, it's true because, you know, like I've said to many people, you know, whether I'm working on the school roof project or the EMS or, you know, the sewer things. It's always, you know, these large amount of monies, and that's why I was concerned. You know, we already have, you know, high bills, and we got all these things that we're dealing with. You know, it's tough.
It is tough. And that's why we're trying to make everything accountable and separate so you can track.
Sure.
Yep. And with our new software and Brenda's really been on top of it.
That's why I changed up on how I do my budgets too.
Yep.
Because before in the past, there was only like 9 or 10 line items and stuff just got shoved in there. Okay, well, right.
Related to
or,
that.
Or it was, they only allotted so much for this one, but I'm just throw it out. Tree budget, okay. They only allotted $10,000. Well, you know what? Well, I used more than $10,000 this year, so I'm going to steal it from this other account over here.
And no one can see it.
Because realistically, like when I get my budget, here's the number I got. And here are all the line items that I take it away from.
Mm-hmm.
But realistically, the town and the account and the whole nine yards, all they care is I don't overspend that bottom number.
Right.
And how I manipulate in between is what I need to do. So what I've done is I've tried to add line items, which makes it a little bit more difficult for me. And in the beginning, it was a little bit more difficult for Brenda, but now things are starting to move a little bit smoother. So now I can actually track to see where my monies were going to. You know, in
Absolutely.
The past, hypothetically, patchwork, okay? That all went underneath road materials, okay?
Right.
Well, I went through $22,000 worth of road materials. Okay, well, how much of that was patch? How much of that was gravel? How much of that went to dirt roads? How much of that went to actually paved roads? Blah, 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 blah. Now I've got it separated out, so now I've got a little bit better handle on where my stuff's actually going to.
Yeah.
So that way, when a question's asked to me, I can flip open my book and say, well, this is where it went.
Right.
So instead of just grouping stuff together.
Yep. That's the way transparency is good.
And I know it's harder, Kevin, but I really appreciate it because otherwise we're not really managing.
Exactly.
And we can't track it because, like, you know, when the roads wash out, when I was talking to you about our dirt roads washing out, we need to know those numbers so we can go out and hustle for money to fix them once, and that's it.
Yep.
And because the constant bleeding of it is what uses up all our money. So anyway, thank you.
Thank
I really appreciate. I really appreciate you,
you.
Doing you this. Thank you very much,
have
Kevin.
You too.
For
yeah.
Sure.
Well, there's no sense in making you stay. So let's go back up to select board comments. Kip, can you give us an update on the school roof?
The school roof is going along just fine. The
contractor. Thank you to you.
Well,
let me tell you, I'm sitting in there.
The contractor is doing a great job.
Good.
They're ahead of schedule.
Really,
there's virtually no problems, no issues. All the product that has been ordered is on site, with the exception of the air conditioning, but that will be there in a week. They're not ready to install it anyways.
And we have the better shingles.
We have the new shingles.
Yep.
They're on site.
They're already on the building.
Nice. Yeah. They're on the building.
So they're on the roof. Great.
They came Thursday.
Perfect.
And our meeting was Wednesday. They were there Thursday afternoon. Yeah. So
you saved the whole week of...
The swap out was not a big deal.
Great.
Yep. And I can also report that the fire alarm system in the school works well because the janitors were in there dusting and that broke the beam, which the beam thought was smoke, and so all the alarms went off and the fire department responded. So it works well.
Good.
That's the roof. Roof is fine.
Great.
Let's see, what was I going to...
Well, we have SCEMS we could talk about.
Yeah, we could talk about that.
We had our successful first meeting, I think.
I think so.
Yep.
We're going to be working on that.
Yep. Things are going along well, so... Yeah.
Yeah, it was good. It was really good to learn and listen to them and understand where they're at and explain how much we really care about that service and want it to succeed and find a home. And
when we were going over the budget... I couldn't really follow it all that well because I didn't know what a lot of those line items were.
Yeah.
But I spent a short amount of time with Zach today, and he went over every single one, so I got a good idea of exactly what. So next time I'll be able to follow it and understand, what exactly is going on.
Speaking of which,
like that. So.
Doug,
and
I was wondering.
I'm sorry if you had questions.
Can we get a copy of that?
You know, I just didn't feel that
budget.
I should hold everybody up because I didn't. There was 30, 40 things on there, What is this?
And it wasn't really correct.
I had a general idea of what it was. It was a lot of like the little abbreviations that I just didn't know what they were, you know, so. But now I...
There is lingo.
Yeah, it's the lingo. Well, that's what's been a little tricky for me because, you know, whether it's a school or EMS or the sewer, the lingo's all changed. So when I said...
All the acronyms.
Oh, yeah, the acronyms. I mean, it's ALS. I mean, you know, you can think of Lou Gehrig's disease. No, you know, it's an ambulance. No, it's advanced life. So, you know, things like that.
That means more money. Just remember that.
What's that?
ALS is more money. More money reimbursement.
Right.
So you want to see the ALS numbers high.
If you're going to have any.
Yeah. Yes.
If you're going to have anybody going
and,
out.
And the intercept number's low. And that was one thing that, you know, having the impact shift on is going to keep our intercept numbers lower, I think, because that means we'll have able to run a paramedic service on multiple vehicles. So that was... You know, that was important.
Yes.
Because to me, intercept money, you should just, that's money you're burning.
Yep.
And so I'd rather see our staff be paid and have that on instead of burning up intercept money.
Yeah. Yeah.
So
it makes sense.
So anyway, I think it was successful and we will have more meetings and.
Yeah. Yep. I think it was great.
Going for, I don't know if this is appropriate time, but I did. Read a letter was directed to the water department, and it basically was concerning the water line that goes through the Oxford property.
Oh, yeah. Why don't you talk about that, Kip?
There was just some concern as to, the new owners of the property being the bakery. Their attorney wanted to provide the town with an easement. I don't know if option is a proper term, but the water main does go through their property to service the highway department. So, you know, that we have to deal with that as far as, you know, because it's not public property. So if that water main broke on private property, you know, all the tenants or all the landowners within that park, if you will, would be responsible. And that's the gist of what that, letter is all about. But I didn't like the way I took some of the wording in it. I wasn't comfortable with it, but... You know, if our attorney reads it and sees that it's fair.
The first draft of a side agreement related to the easement across that property is before town's attorney. I have not heard back from Sarah Bellino as to her response to it. That contract is still under negotiation.
Okay.
Broadly
but they
speaking,
have it, but they have that question before them?
I'm sorry, the question of...
Or looking at the easement.
That's what the whole side agreement is all about, is maintaining
the
easement, maintaining responsibility for repairs, regardless of who purchases the property, maintaining the town's right of way to access the property, and also setting up a division of costs for the maintenance of those lines amongst the three property owners, potentially the three property owners. The town is the owner of the highway department lot, the potential buyer of the larger lot, and then any future potential buyer of the 2.5 acre lot that remains.
Right. Okay.
There's that. It's so it's before the town's attorneys. We don't have a final agreement to present to you for consideration.
Yeah. All right. It sounds like they're going to review it.
Yeah. Well,
feel comfortable or not.
Yeah. I as long as they say it's okay. Some of the wording to me was a little ambiguous. I didn't want the town to be in a position where, if there was a problem there, that these people, in a sense, could just repair it and cut it off at that end and, you know, basically say, you know, you can get your water from the town, you know, because now they own that pipe. You know, we don't. So.
I had a question about, I'm not sure where quite to bring it up, but I was approached about somebody looking to present to the town for services as far as our law services. And I didn't know where they would do that. When would we? Does anybody compete for that, or is it something we just choose? And
You don't have to go out to bid for law services, but who was interested?
Amy Royal, and she works with she has an all woman law service locally, and they work with municipalities and labor negotiations. And they service other
municipalities around, and they're local, and they were inquiring about, you know, why ours are out so far from local, and can they have at least an opportunity to come and present? So I didn't know where we could do that, or at least listen to a bid on that, or a presentation on that at some point.
Well, just to give you a little background, I was on the planning board in the early 80s, 81 or 82, and Mark Bobrowski was, you know, relatively young. Mm-hmm. I mean, well, we're talking a long time ago, but he was just out of school, and he is like, he wrote a book on land use, and he represented us quite a few times on the planning board. He was very, very sharp, and he is actually the expert in the state on land use.
Nice.
So that's how I got used, you know, like that firm.
Yeah.
And Lisa Mead is his partner.
Yep.
And so I was.
And they've served the town very well.
Having gone to housing court and different courts with Bud Pepin, who was our lawyer at the time, I was pretty disgusted with the level of service, I guess.
Yeah.
It can be public.
Sure.
And, it was very hard to get people, convince them that we didn't need to have a local lawyer,
right,
that we really needed a sharp lawyer.
A sharp lawyer.
That we're not going to lose in court.
Sure.
And that would show up, because that was also an issue.
Oh, no.
So I, you know, cooked up a potluck, you know, or had made lunch and... because there's no budget. So
right.
I made lunch and invited everybody in so they could meet Lisa and talk to Lisa and Mark, and it went well. So we voted to go with Mark and Lisa's firm. So we've had them for quite a few years. I don't know how many years, more than 10.
Yep.
Because it was one of the things that kind of bugged me. We were getting charged money every month. I don't know, like $3,000 a month.
Wow.
For no services.
Yeah.
And I mean no services.
Right.
Not even a bill. Nothing even listed on a bill. We'd just get a bill for $3,000.
Yes.
And it was like, we can't afford this.
No.
And I know we're not getting no service. So, you know, so we did this. We switched and we've kind of done it. So. Yeah.
I just didn't.
I mean,
wasn't sure how it worked or how it didn't work.
Do you know who they have for towns?
I can find out. I mean, I could gather some info. I just didn't know where you got it.
I guess I'd kind of like references because
absolutely, it's a major decision.
Yeah, it is. I mean, partly is because if you feel confident in your legal
person, and that's the most important,
then you feel like you could go to court and and win.
Yeah,
I mean, if you go to court, you want to win. So, I don't know. I mean, it's not that I wouldn't be open. It's just
And I wasn't even sure. So I just
make
thought
sure we'd have
I said
really
I would ask
good,
and see where you know how the process went and if it was worth entertaining or not.
What is our annual budget for legal fees?
Legal fees right now.
20,000.
Give me a second and I can bring it up.
We're about 20,000 for like leases, and then we do have a labor council.
Correct.
So if they're due labor, we could look into it because we have switched our labor around trying to find better people.
Legal services for FY17 is 23,000. In FY16, it was 20,000. For FY16, however, I know we spent closer to 27 or 28,000.
Yeah, it depends on what happens.
In the real world, that's not a lot of money for a good lawyer.
It's not at all a lot of money for an attorney.
And it kind of, and because we were one of the first customers ever of Mark, or clients of Mark's. He, you know, they used to come out here and not charge us. He'd go visit his family and go fishing or something and not charge us. But being current now, they do charge us when they come out. But they still don't call, you know, charge us if like I make a phone call and say, well, what about this?
Right.
What about that? We don't get charged for that. But.
Yep.
We do get charged for distance now, which we weren't before. But that's legit. I mean, we have changed our legal, our labor lawyer around because we had some issues.
I remember.
And again, overpricing. I felt we were overcharged. And I am really cranky about making sure we get if we're paying, we need top of the line.
Absolutely.
And
absolutely.
And if they expect us to pay, then we want the best. And I didn't feel like we were getting the best, so we switched. And I don't really have much opinion of the one we have now because we haven't
really used.
We haven't had a situation where we've had to go to court or litigation or.
That's all so good things.
Yeah.
But maybe I'd just ask
sometimes,
for some
though,
references.
Sometimes, though, it is good just to listen, get other
opinions.
Oh,
absolutely.
Sometimes you just might be surprised.
Yeah.
Curious.
I'm just only
I don't
that,
want to upset the apple cart
no,
either.
No, no, no. But it would be good to find out of who else they represent. Mm-hmm. And if it's a labor lawyer, I'm more open because we kind of are switching around anyway.
Right.
But
so I'll find out who they represent, and maybe they'd come and do a small presentation.
And if they've had cases,
correct.
Have they won?
Correct. We'd want to see that.
Yes.
I think they have, but we will. We'll get some info.
Are they smart enough that we don't entail costs?
Exactly.
Because part of the thing is you don't want to go to court. So are they keeping
us
out of court?
A better thing would be a legal counsel for a town that never had cases that got brought into court.
Correct.
That actually would be more impressive.
I know.
Sure.
Yeah.
But I mean.
Well, we'll see.
The law firm that we have now, I feel confident that when they tell us something, that we can go to court, we're going to win.
Mm-hmm.
And you know what? So we can give them the answer, and you can stand up and say, you know, tough.
You
can threaten
confident.
All you want, right?
You
can threaten all you want, but this is what our opinion is.
One thing I've heard a couple of times in speaking with either Lisa Mead or Sarah Bellino is actually, I'm not sure, or I don't know.
I'll get
because
back to you.
It's immediately followed by, let me check with Mark, or let me check with Lisa, or let me do some research and get back to you. They're not going to provide answers that they're not quite certain of. They always want to verify their own information. That's actually a really good
absolutely.
Thing. Because it makes
any
me
business.
Trust their opinions a little bit more.
Yep.
The comfort level is really good with that law firm, but that's if these people do labor stuff, I don't know, Doug hasn't had... You haven't had to call our labor council too much.
I've spoken with our labor council once for about 30 minutes in a conference call, and that was several months ago.
Yeah.
And I think
so.
Supposedly
they're good.
Yep.
And they're certainly a huge improvement over what we had. But we haven't had much experience with them either, so.
Okay.
If they're doing labor.
Well, I'll get a little more information anyways and pass it to the board.
You know what you do is then you call around and try to... See what other people think. And
sure.
So, and then we'll...
We'll make
a
decision.
Open to
we'll
it.
Just,
I'm open to
we'll
it.
We'll just see what they have to say. Okay.
And what their... And you want to know
their
how they're going to bill us.
And
because,
how they bill us. And,
yeah, because they'll tell you a dollar an hour, you know, amount for an hour, but then how are they billing us for other things?
Correct.
You know,
we'll get
a total
full
bill. Yeah.
Get some full information.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, no. Thank you for trying to find new things, because it's... Yeah. It is good to look at these things.
Yeah.
I mean, and times and things do change.
Sure.
But, like I said, Western and Sampson used to be, when Dan Lawrence was here, he, you know, would do stuff for free.
And then
wait
pay
until
when the grant,
when
came,
when
in
the grant came in. And they're not carrying us anymore.
That's hard
so
to
that's,
do
so that's a risk now because we have to pay up front for some engineering. And so you want to be sure that... We have a chance to get the grant, and money's harder. It's harder to get grants now.
Absolutely.
So, I don't know. I mean, so now I'm not, like, tied to that engineering firm like we were.
Correct.
So, anyway.
Okay, thank you. Anything else you want to?
No. Kip, you wanted to talk about the next item.
Next one?
Yeah.
Things over on Mill Village Road have... Not only not improved, they've gotten worse.
Is that right?
Yes.
Oh.
So
I go by there all the time.
I think that it's time, that we act on the letter that was sent to that area. We have the ability.
Copy
of that.
Right?
I think the 14 days is the 29th.
It'll be the end of this week. So
yeah.
I think that we should have Dick write him the letter, and say from that day forward that. The fines will be $500 a day until the situation is corrected. I also think that we should contact our present attorney and find out, how what procedure that we need to follow is, if this isn't followed up, do we put an attachment on the property for non-payment of the thing, and then, you know, go forward that way? You know, I think that's something that should start now as well, because it's not going to happen overnight.
And how those fines are assessed, I know that he's in violation of several, you know, I see six things here.
Yes.
And, you know, some may carry different fines, or how they get fined, or if it's a, I don't know how you...
What you can do is you can pick multiple things, but a lot of them, or the sections of the law, say up to $1,000 a day. And there's multiple ones there. And so instead of, you know, saying, well, so much for this vehicle, say, I don't want to get into a game where, well, I move one of these, so it should go down to 50. You know, this is a dollar
all
amount.
All these items.
And it needs to be straightened out. And if you don't, well, this is what it's going to do, and we'll just have to see what goes. But I think that we need to be proactive and let the attorney know this, and, you know, have them start going. Because in a short amount of time, in within a month, that's going to be $15,000. Now, if somebody doesn't pay their property taxes for 3 years, the town would put an attachment on the property. So this is going to be an accelerated thing.
So he hasn't done anything over there?
No, there's been more dumpsters there, tree stumps, more vehicles running.
Okay. Well,
yeah.
Given the opportunity. To...
Doug, can you consult with Dick and Lisa?
Exactly. I was
or
going to
check in with Lisa at least.
Well, what I'd like to do is set up a conference call with Dick and myself and speak with Lisa about this matter. I'll start by getting materials from the building commissioner to send to Lisa as a prologue, so she can read up on what's happening up to this point. And then we'll have a conference call to basically talk about the procedure by which this can be done.
Probably scan the whole
file. Expect to, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Just so that she has the whole background, that it's not arbitrary.
So should I make a motion that we set this $500 a day fine to go forward?
After the 29th? Or?
It would be after the 29th.
Be after providing the 29th. Providing the attorney's
direction
from the attorney.
Yep.
Yeah.
Sure.
Second. Is there any further discussion?
No.
Nope.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Make sure Dick has this information for tomorrow, okay?
I would suspect he's watching.
Okay. Board of Health, comments, just that it's been incredibly dry, so, you know, we've had less mosquitoes, but...
Maybe they're trapping them all. Who knows?
No. What little water we had, we actually doubled our mosquito what was in the traps because of that little bit of rain we had a couple of weeks ago.
They're looking for water.
Yeah. Well, it explodes. It explodes when there's water. So that's why it's so serious. If we have rain Friday, people patrol their yards so that we don't have hatching going on in, you know, a week to 10 days. But we aren't paying for the testing. We had I put in your box these letters.
Yes, I saw this.
And actually, believe it or not,
I didn't have a chance to read them all.
No. Well,
you say the same thing, right?
Yes.
No, they don't.
The letter is the same. We're just inviting all these people.
All these different
health,
people.
The State Department of Health laboratories. I mean.
Yes, yeah. Because we're having this big meeting here. And
on August 3rd?
Yeah, actually, okay. I think it's going to happen. I actually thought they were going to blow us off, but they are coming.
Right.
And, at least some of them are coming so far. And I'm trying to sort this out because we are, DPH right now is paying to have our pools, all our mosquitoes tested for free. It's about $30 a pool to get tested, and they're testing them for free. So
Great. We
aren't paying for testing. So we're trying to figure out why they're offering us to do this, because the towns that pay for, they have a mosquito control board, it's a reclamation board, they are all paying, and why would they do us for free? And I think the reason they were doing us for free is because we've been trying to organize for over 3 years, and
then we went out and got a private contractor, and we were going to go through the UMass lab because it was a 24-hour turnaround for us.
Quick return.
Yeah, and it's cheaper than the DPH lab. And so I think they were afraid that we were going off by ourselves. And so we need to find out why they're doing this. Is this going to be sustainable? Are they offering us for free? Because their charge for, you know, mosquito control district was, well, in some cases, 300 to 500% of what we're paying for VDCI. And we can't afford that.
No.
I mean, $11,000 was a hard sell. And I'm still going to convince Kip that it was worth it. But, you know, we're certainly not going to be able to afford, you know, $40,000 or $50,000 or $60,000 for the same darn thing.
Right.
And it's actually less service because they don't turn around the testing as fast.
Correct.
And that's the whole point.
Right.
Is that
you
if we have something circulating. So we have a couple weeks. Disease doesn't usually show up until the end of August into September. Mm-hmm. So we have a couple weeks to sort of fiddle
couple
around.
A couple weeks for the disease to show up? Or
yeah, no, before anything starts. It becomes crucial to get good turnaround. So we're trying to figure out what's going on. And
okay.
Anyway.
Okay. So on the 3rd, we're meeting here.
Yeah, so I'm going to have this meeting here on the 3rd, and you're more than welcome to come, but it's just going to be,
okay,
you know, trying to figure out what the scoop is,
yep,
with DPH and what the relationship is with us. Is their free sampling going to be really free, and when are they going to start charging us, and are they just trying to undermine us? And I don't know. It's a good thing that we have fun together, the other towns, and we get together and we meet and whatever.
Do you dress up like mosquitoes too? I mean.
Tuesday we had a meeting, and we have another meeting on Tuesday next week to get ready for this meeting. And but everybody else is a good move, you know, good eggs, and so we're meeting and trying to figure this out. And in the meantime, we're not spending money, so
right,
that should make you happy.
Yes.
That we're we're trapping stuff, and there was an Asian tiger mosquito that showed up in Windsor, Connecticut. So it's actually important that we keep testing stuff.
Yep.
And it's caused quite a stir in Massachusetts. So
good. Thanks for stirring it up.
Yeah. We'll see. Anyway, that's the one that carries Zika.
Yes.
But so hopefully there will be no Zika circulating. I really didn't think that is a really overblown risk for Massachusetts at this point. Our concern is really, if there's West Nile positive, people shouldn't be freaking out, because in general there's not really
not as bad as Triple E.
Yeah, Triple E is what's scary.
Mm-hmm.
And that, we know that circulates, and we just got to nail it down.
I haven't heard of any outbreaks or any cases of that in the state
so
far this
they're
year.
They're trapping Triple E diseases, but there's no cases yet.
Right.
So, now they just had that one random case in Orange, which was, I don't, you know, yeah. But they don't trap out here, so we don't know how serious it is. We know the horses get it.
Yeah.
I mean, everybody vaccinates their horses, and they had last year was a bad year for horses, because horses, even though they were vaccinated, were still getting Triple E.
Hmm.
And so we knew it was circulating, and Northampton was trapping Triple E mosquitoes, and so that community was really on board early this year.
Yep.
They started back in May. So
while we're still on the Board of Health things, I'd like to kind of jump a little bit back to the sewer study committee. The question was asked of me is, how long was this committee supposed to be together? Just for a year, and just to study it and come up with a recommendation? It's not something that needs to be ongoing.
We can determine
that down the road.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
If you feel it's useful, then you keep it together. Okay. If you want to change the mission, we just say, change the mission.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you can put together a committee of whoever when we want to solve a problem, and you disband it when you want.
Would either of you have any objections to appointing Bob Decker to that committee as well? He's been into both of them anyways, and he'd like to be involved.
Oh, no.
And he has a lot of background in that. And
I'll make a motion to appoint Bob Decker to the Sewer Study Commission.
And I second that.
Right.
Is there any further discussion?
No.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Just to make sure I got this
We added one more person.
No, right, I got that. I just want to make sure that it's just under the general business of the,
yeah,
on the agenda, that is.
Well, I added under Board of Health if there are comments, but.
It's interesting, as I was we were looking for certain materials for the sewer study committee, and Kat Dolan came up with a box and said, what about these? And we opened it up, and it was yellowed and brown paper, blue copy, like mimeographed copies.
Oh, wow.
Dated 1941, 1943, 1947.
Awesome.
Bob Decker. The name was on there. And I am assuming it's not Robert J. Decker III. I am assuming
right.
It was the second or the first.
His dad was the sewer commissioner in town back then. So
yeah. And it was interesting. Some of them had to deal with, well, there's a new house being built on Grave Street. They're going to be asking for sewer. What do we do? And we need to make a recommendation. It was,
wow.
Just incredible history of the massive growth of houses immediately following the war.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
In South Deerfield.
When everybody came home.
And the build out of the sewers. Yeah.
Did you find the streetscape stuff?
We did not find the streetscape materials from the Conway School of Landscape Design. However, part of my report was going to be the meeting that I had with Kristen and with Jane Trigier. Kristen, and her last name escapes me. She came up from the Conway School of Landscape Design, which is now located in East Hampton, apparently. We determined the exact date of that study, and she's going to go back and look at the materials again to see if we can find
it. Okay, there's another study in between, and
there
I
was?
Will. Yes, and I will look for it at home. See
Do
if
you know
I have
who
something.
Did it?
It was part of our master plan in 2000.
Okay, I do have the master plan from 2000, and if it's integrated in there, we can dig it up.
It isn't, but it came out of when we did the master plan process.
Okay.
We actually hired somebody, and I'm blanking out on the name.
Okay.
But we hired somebody to do some preliminary work.
Okay.
So there's the landscape, Conway School, then this other one,
okay.
And then the third one,
okay.
Which was not too
the
long
more
ago.
Recent
right.
Charettes that happened in 2015.
Yes.
Yeah. Yep.
So I will look for those, see if I can find any reference to stuff, but to tell you the truth, it's probably up in the barn, because that was pretty little, a long time ago. I mean, it was around 2000. I have boxes of stuff. Every time there's a holiday, I have to box up stuff and haul it away. Okay. What do we have to? We have to vote on Pat Kroll to be assistant vaccine manager.
You have a request from Lisa White in your packet.
Mm-hmm.
To do exactly that. It's basically formalizing what Pat has been doing, and this is necessary just for the state licensing and continued reporting.
If you guys don't have a problem, I'll make the motion just to appoint Pat. It's for backup when Lisa's not here or whenever.
Right. I'll second it.
And it's good to have somebody local, because if we had emergency where we lose power, Pat comes in, make sure that the generator kicks on, or we move it over to the police department.
Okay.
No
generator over there?
Yeah. Well, the generator works better over there.
Okay.
I think we've taken care of it, but every time we talk about generators, it seems to be issues.
I understand.
Anyway, if there's no further discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Next item on the agenda is electricity stuff. Kip.
I reached out to Colonial Power, Mark Capardano, and he told me that he had spoken with Doug at some point a while back, and he's going to forward me a bunch of information sometime this week, and I'll bring it to the board, and we'll have an option. I've heard that our current supplier is having some real problems, so that source might dry up anyways.
Okay.
But there's another area that I've reached out to, but I haven't heard back from them yet. So.
Do you remember the name of the company?
That I reached out to?
Yeah.
No.
A third company that comes to mind is Good Energy?
Good Energy, there you go.
Is that it?
Yes.
Okay, then that's the second company.
Yep.
Okay.
What's this for again?
Our electricity.
Oh, okay.
We buy through Hampshire.
That's right. Okay.
Hampshire Cog.
Yep.
They've been having some.
I would strongly urge getting the Energy Resources Committee involved.
Okay.
I know that they've been trying to look at some of this, and they may have some information that could be useful.
Great.
You know what? You can call Dave Keith. He's a chair of the Energy Committee. He knows a lot of stuff.
How do you spell his last name? Just E-E?
E-I-T-H.
Oh, Keith.
Yep.
I thought you were saying Keith.
No. He lives in Old Deerfield.
Okay.
Behind Joanne Creelman's house. His little house is behind there.
I was talking to people. I even sold Joanne Creelman motorcycles.
Oh. Well, it's right behind. His house is right behind her house.
Yep.
They share a driveway.
Yeah.
And anyway, he's very knowledgeable, so that would help you do some of the work. But that's really good. Thank you.
Well, I really just reached out to them because I figured they would have, kind of this information. He said that he'd be happy to come and make a presentation, in front of us.
Good.
But I wanted to get a few choices and get things lined up.
Electricity or energy contracts are exempt from public procurement. That being said, it does make sense to get as much information as possible.
Sure.
And to hear from as many companies as possible so you can make an informed choice.
Yeah. Well, I've been trying to reach out. There was I know that there's somebody, I'm not sure if she lives in town or wherever. She used to work for the power department at the HUCOG. And I had a conversation once with her in the springtime about where these other folks get it from. So I'm trying to, eliminate more of the middlemen and trying to dig deeper. But I haven't had much luck quite yet. But
actually, it's very complicated. I went to three or four seminars, and
it's complicated for a reason.
I know.
Just like, those meetings we have over at the elementary school roof. They're complicated for a reason.
Yeah, but
so it requires guides to get you through.
Yes.
I won't go into that.
You won't go into that.
No. There is some other complications, for sure.
Okay.
So I'm glad that you want to look at them, because it was, I know Mark Gilmore and I both went, and it was complicated.
Yeah, you walk away shaking your head.
Yeah. I had more questions, and it seemed like doing the COG was the safe, guaranteed. What was confusing is you had all these options that could go either way.
Yeah.
And, you're trying to make a budgeting decision, so the COG seems safe. So if you have, and that's, times have changed, but if the options are still risky, it's hard for us to make a decision from a budgeting point of view.
There was a point where I was involved with, dealing with credit card companies, dealing with the percentages. Some companies would charge 1% or 2% or 3%. Then you dealt with, qualified purchases, not qualified. And, it kept going round and round. And finally, I end up meeting this one guy. He says, all that is just smoke and mirrors, because the bottom line is, what do you pay? And that's really the truth.
True.
And he said, look, this is what we're going to charge you. And I end up dealing with him, and, I end up cutting my cost. And all the other people say, oh, well, we can lower this rate, or we can, qualify. And, if you have more purchases, we'll charge you $50 a month, but you have to pay 25 cents per transaction. It's like, it's just all smoke and mirrors. The bottom line is, how much do you pay? And I think that's what I would be expecting from whoever. I don't want to hear all that. I want to know, what's it going to cost us,
Yep.
I think it would be great if they could do a, presentation.
And I'll listen, but I don't want to get into all details, because the bottom line is, how much is it going to cost us? Just get to that point and, let's be on our way.
Yeah.
Yep.
So thanks. Next item on the agenda is job description for town administrator. Have you guys had a chance to read that yet?
I was just going through that now.
I think the thing that, I guess, the descriptor here, Doug, I need you to look at it too, but
yep.
It says directly responsible to the Board of Selectmen for the management of staff and administration. It should really be facilitating of communication, because, we've really made an effort to hire very competent department heads.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not, you're not, the town administrator isn't really managing the department heads, but what it's doing is facilitating communication.
A comment. You're looking to change it from a town administrator to a town coordinator.
No. I had this argument with Mark. We're not downgrading to a town coordinator because what you're doing is facilitating communication, and that's different than managing. That
managing connotates that you are, they report to you. And that's, we've been over this and over this. There isn't that link.
Broadly speaking, there are three different types of people who would be in this position. I'm sorry, three different, that's incorrect. Three different types of jobs at this level. One is a manager, which actually draws from policy decisions, but has full hiring and firing authority for all departments in town. One is a town administrator that has oversight of departments, but has no hiring or firing authority. That appointment and withdrawal power still rests in the select board. And then a person who does exactly what you just described, coordinates communication between the select board and other entities, but has no oversight of those departments. And that's, and I'm simply saying that broadly speaking, those are the three different classes of jobs.
And from what I gathered from you, his latter description is what you were thinking. Is that correct?
Well, it's just, you know, we talk about it, I don't know how many times we've talked about it, probably 5 or 6 times in the last 10 years. But for whatever reason, that term management stays, or some descriptor like that stays in there, and we always end up discussing that it's a facilitator of communication. We made, and it's
because
working together collaboratively, and
because we don't want that position to manage any of the department heads.
That's right, and because what we've done is on purpose.
Right, we hire people who manage those departments.
Right, right. So it's a reporting system kind of thing versus a
looking at
could
the
you just
functions.
Change, get rid of where it says all town affairs and just, you know, somehow change the wording so they
well,
they
I was just thinking, I was even of a less of an impact, just say directly responsible to the Board of Selectmen for the
coordination
and collaboration of communication with staff and administration. I don't know, something like that.
Yeah.
It is a collaborative, it's you're in charge of making sure we know what's going on, and but you're not micromanaging the departments. I mean, that's what we pay our department heads for.
So looking
I
at the essential functions.
I'm just not sure. I just kind of person I'm going to need, I would need a few hours just sitting at home alone trying to word it right. But I know exactly what you mean. And,
okay.
You know, I mean, basically kind of what he's doing now.
So looking at the essential functions, you're looking at striking A.
The town administrator shall supervise and be responsible for the efficient administration of all the department. Right?
You're looking at making C be the primary position or the primary duty. You're looking at eliminating some of D. E would roughly stay in place.
Mm-hmm.
What would we
F
be getting?
F and G would roughly stay in place.
What will we be getting rid of in D?
The fact that the town administrator is the chief budget officer of the town and coordinating a budget. If the town administrator has no authority to supervise department heads, then the town administrator can't say, we need to do this and this and this with our budget this year, and can't submit a consolidated budget to the board.
You couldn't communicate that?
You feel like you weren't still being able to do that.
I'm thinking that if the town administrator is no longer the director.
We make the final decision on the budget anyway, but you coordinate it. Again, it's a coordinating and communicating thing. If we communicate to you that we have to cut 2% of the budget, or we want to keep it under 2%, you know, we don't have the money this year, you know, I would expect you to talk to department heads and say, okay, the priority is, you know, coming in and around this number is a growth or a decrease or whatever, and this, you know, you got to prioritize what's happening in your departments and come and talk to the select board, come be prepared to the select board of why it's important to do whatever you're doing so they can make a decision of how it does. Because you know, making a 2% cut across the board is not real, is not good management, because every year mm-hmm. there's going to be a priority of what is happening. So it's not, you know, if somebody comes and says, this is like the tree budget, let's go back to the tree budget. We haven't been doing that. We cut the tree budget years past, so we're behind, and that tree budget has to get done because it's building up and it's becoming a safety issue. So even though we're going to cut the budget 2%, we will fund an increase in the tree budget, that kind of thing. Why wouldn't you do that, Doug? I mean, I don't see that's a change at all. You would relay that information from Kevin, or Kevin would come and present it, and we try to figure out how to take care of a increase in the tree budget when we're trying to cut the budget by 2% or whatever.
So, but broadly speaking, you're still seeing the Board of Selectmen as being the active manager of the town?
We have always been. That's not a change. Well, I don't understand.
Okay, so we need to modify this job description to make it match reality. Make it match what has been.
We can put it out and we don't change it, but we've had this discussion I don't know how many times.
I'm not arguing with any of the points you're raising. I'm simply saying that if we're going to put the job description out for hire, we need to make sure that the job description states what your expectations are for the position, so that someone doesn't come in expecting to be a manager of all departments and instead to not be the manager.
Carol, how about if we all take it home, and I mean, I feel I have a good grasp on what you're saying.
Right.
And I'd
well,
like.
I mean, you see that's kind of what we do.
Yeah,
right.
I get that.
Okay.
But I see Doug's point as far as the wording, and it people could take it the wrong way,
mm-hmm.
and you know, so if you want to change the wording to avoid that, I understand. But I would like to, you know, take this home and think about it and make
okay.
some changes. Then
no, I wasn't trying
next,
to rush you.
No, and then maybe okay. at our next meeting, or if you feel the need that we need to do this quicker, maybe we could meet next Wednesday and just deal with this. And
mm-hmm.
Well, I don't even think it's that big a deal, because it's you're just wordsmithing it. So mm-hmm. if we agree that to go forward with the, you know, posting of the job, I think we could talk about the words.
Well,
is it
a violation of our open meeting laws if we all take this home, make some changes, and let Doug put it together? Then we all look at it separately,
okay.
and would that be a good function?
Well, Doug could take our changes and then
right.
redo it. I don't think it would be, because it's just wordsmithing.
And
a couple sentences.
We would still want the town administrator to have some teeth, right? I mean,
oh, yeah. I mean, you have to. We're not here full time.
Right.
But the idea is, you know,
to
over
be more
the years,
of a collaboration.
We, right. Over the years, we've replaced our department heads with very capable,
mm-hmm.
because we expect more.
Right.
We expect more for our dollars, and we expect them to be on top of stuff. So it was never, you know, funneled down. It was always, the intent was to have them more accountable. Like Kevin was saying, he added more line items,
mm-hmm.
and he manages the budget day to day now. We have software that gives us, everybody needs to be on top of their budget and know where every penny is.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have slush funds anymore. We don't have line items that aren't spent for the most part.
Yeah.
You know, most at the end of the year, most things are spent down.
Right.
And so, you know, we just have sharp department heads.
Yeah.
Or we expect more of them. I don't want to say in comparison that they weren't sharp before, but it just, we've replaced them with the understanding that they have to be on top of stuff and managing their money and giving us good service for the money has been crucial, because we don't have much money anymore.
Right.
And it's only getting worse.
Mm-hmm.
And so they have to produce for that dollar. And we want to know, because we get the complaints, we get what's happening, and we're voted in or voted out based on, you know, if the town is running well.
Right.
And so you're more, I mean, at least me, I don't want to volunteer my time if it doesn't really mean anything.
It's true.
You know, I mean,
we
want to
be
have
here
impact.
To make a difference.
you want to be able to have impact on how things are going, so.
Well, that's the tough part about this job, is that, you know, sometimes the proper choice is a difficult one for other people to swallow, you know.
But that's why we're responsible, too. I mean, try to make the best decision as possible, and then you own up. I mean, I'm accountable for my decisions, and so I feel that if people don't like them, then you just vote us out, you know. But we're trying to make do with what we have and produce for what we have. And so, you're talking with your department heads on a regular basis, and you're hustling money on a regular basis because you're trying to, you know, bring more money in or whatever.
Yeah. So this fall's potluck, you're going to make mosquito soup?
I'm telling you, this mosquito stuff is driving me crazy.
All right. So why don't we do that? Why don't we
take it
do
home
what
and
we
take
want
a look?
To do, and then we just forward our ideas to Doug, and we'll go from there.
Okay. I wasn't looking at this as a major redo.
Right.
No.
I was just thinking a couple words.
No, I get it, because, you know, it might be misleading, you know, if you get a candidate that doesn't understand it, then all of a sudden you say, well, we do this, we do that. It's like, well, you know, that's not really what
she's changing.
Right. So, I mean, I was looking at the word management up here as the word that was giving me a problem. And then you have to reflect what you change that with to the other things.
The essential functions.
Otherwise, it was fairly tracked. I mean, and we have looked at this. This is from 2012, is it, Doug, or 2014?
I believe it's 14. Updated 2014.
Yep. I think so, too. Oh, it does. It says January 2014. So we've been doing this for a while. We've done it two or three times lately.
I think you also need to take a look at the bylaws for the town, because I believe some of the responsibilities for this are in the bylaws.
Okay.
I want to quickly just check that myself.
Again,
give me a second to
pick those up. I wasn't planning on changing too much. It's just that this is always an issue.
There's a number of jobs that...
Yeah, I get it.
And if we're going to post, we want it to not be the issue, or at least more gray.
What section of bylaws would administrative management come in under? You know?
And I think I stand corrected. There are a number of jobs that are encoded in the bylaws. However, I don't believe town administrator is one of them. So I stand corrected on that.
Okay.
Does this reference, you know, I can't remember now, does this reference that there's a contract? We usually... There was some discussion that whether we wanted a contract or not. So usually...
A contract on what? For the position?
Yeah.
I would be extremely hesitant. I don't like that idea at all. Yeah. My own opinion. But.
Well, I know.
What's that?
A contract.
Because, you know, if...
Instead of at will, you have a contract.
You know, people come in, and if they want, say somebody comes in and they want a two-year or five-year commitment, you just don't know.
No.
And if it doesn't work out, you know, then you went with the way the situation's set up, it could cost the town a lot of money.
I agree.
I'm sorry, you're suggesting that you would not offer a contract to anyone who was successfully gained the position?
I would be opposed to it, yeah.
That's going to limit your field of candidates.
It might.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's... I think that's okay, because it's the other way with a contract. You know, you really could be stuck. I don't know.
Every contract has an out clause whereby a person can be dismissed for cause. Even contracts that have 2 and 3 year terms, if there's reason to dismiss someone for, you know, failure to perform the duties of the job, that's available to the town.
Yeah, but then that's litigation too, because, you know, is that cause, you know. Is it probably? You know,
anytime you dismiss anybody for cause, there's litigation.
Potentially. That's why we have good lawyers. To eliminate the possibility.
You're banking a lot on these guys.
So far, they've been pretty good.
Yeah.
Well, the labor lawyer, That's why we switched.
I'm looking forward to a little presentation.
Yeah.
See what the ladies can do.
Okay. So we're going to do that. We'll get back to you, Doug. How about your town administrator's report, Doug?
I have just a few brief things. We discussed a lot of what I was going to be mentioning. As I said earlier, I did meet with Jane Trigere and Kristen, forget her last name, from the Conway School of Landscape Design. Mm-hmm. This was a conversation that came about at Jane's request after her discussion through the Historical Commission. She's interested in seeking out assistance from the Conway School of Landscape Design for potential design changes to the town common. Jane is not planning to work on this in a vacuum, but instead will be seeking out assistance from folks like Diane Gribko, John Siz, Mary Andrioli, I think is the name. Mm-hmm. Forgive me for mangling names here. But the expectation is that over the course of this coming fall, a student would provide some input and assistance on creating a design that helps to improve the usability of the common and through proper planting and so on and so forth. The fact that the war memorials are located there, John Siz will definitely be a part of any conversation in regard to those because he's been familiar with the Memorial Day services and the Veterans Day services for the past several years on the common and can speak to that. This was just a very preliminary conversation. We're getting some more information from the Conway School of Landscape Design in regard to what can happen. And the scope of this project would just be inside the bounds of the common to start with. But there was ongoing discussion about what could be done outside of that green space, parking on Park Street, the changing of the flow of traffic at the end of Graves, the possibility of renovating the Leary lot over here just south of the Greenfield Savings Bank, and so on and so forth, to improve the walkability of downtown, to improve accessibility to the local shops, to make the downtown more appealing to potential new merchants, and to expand on the common and give us more room to do things like the summer concerts on the common, the presentations that happen there on a regular basis, and
well,
so on and so
forth. To me, that quickly it just sounds like a contradiction because it's like you can't grow the green space unless you get rid of the parking. You get rid of the parking, it's a detriment to the local merchants. And
that's the thing. Is we've got this whole Leary lot, which is for the most part undeveloped, and if we could create parking there, you could actually double or more than double the amount of parking available within a very, very close walk of downtown. Yep. And so eliminating, say, the three parking spaces tight against the common where the mailbox is right now in favor of expanding the green space there a little bit, you wouldn't lose any parking in the end because you've expanded the parking out here on
As odd as it might sound, I think leaving those parking spaces is kind of a safety thing because the closer you get the green space to the actual flow of the traffic, the more potential there is for a serious accident. You know, I mean, it'd be great if we had a big common, but we don't, you know, and the more plantings you put on there, the less space you have, you know, and it just kind of shrinks it.
Right.
And I'm sure that they might come up with things.
That's part of the conversation.
Yeah.
One of the big things that's been mentioned in the 2013 charrette, it was mentioned a great deal, and probably in the previous studies, was the fact that immediately south of the common, there's a giant open space of pavement where instead of being a 40 or 50 or 60 foot walk from one curb to the other, it's more like 150 feet, and there's no crosswalks. There's no places for people to safely cross.
And that's where the bus gets off.
The bus gets off there.
And that's where that's where some of that space we were going to capture, because it's actually very dangerous for people to cross right there. I mean, that was the discussion, Kip.
There's also been numerous.
It was not giving up the parking places.
Yeah.
Already, it was capturing some.
But
of
you'd,
that
you'd, you could capture some of it, but you'd kind of you're creating a peninsula, you know, or you know, a point there. So yeah, you could, but. But then you would kind of block the traffic coming from Graves Street. They'd be forced to go right instead of straight across. So they'd have to go right. Then you can't take a left, and you know. So then they'd come down, but create more traffic down Conway Street here by the school. That's for sure.
Yeah, no, it would be a talk. But can you just make sure that we incorporate our Oxford Pickle property, whatever is, you know, is walkability. In other words, once the bakers get going, you know, we'd want people being able to come.
Walk to lunch.
Walk to lunch, walk to Wolfie's, walk to Jerry's place, whatever.
Sure.
So that people would utilize the downtown.
Sure. I don't disagree with that at all.
From where was that?
When that, like the bakers, or in that food processing gets going.
I would certainly expect that that's going to be a part of the larger conversation, as would be, you know, the arrangement of sidewalks on Elm Street between Main and the railroad tracks, for example, the use of the intersection there, the arrangement of the intersection, any measures which we might use to slow traffic down as they come off of Sugarloaf, run along Park, and then hop onto North Main, where right now people don't slow down whatsoever, and those would all be part of a larger conversation that I expect is going to take at least 2 years. This is just focused on
none of the streetscapes had taken in consideration the Oxford Pickle property.
No, right, absolutely.
And
yeah.
I just want to make sure we have some flow.
Yep.
Because that's going to, you know, part of it of trying to develop that is to bring people into town that would spend money in town at our local businesses. I mean, you're looking to expand your dollar.
Mm-hmm. And I would probably assume that that would involve sidewalks from the from the back of a potential new building there along Coates Avenue coming out on South Main allow easy access.
And we've had that discussion with
absolutely
New England bakers that
and I know that they're
facilitate.
Yeah. So that was the first preliminary conversation. There'll be more information coming.
Make sure you thank Jane.
Yeah, absolutely.
I really appreciate her volunteering to spearhead this.
She, I think she would welcome input from those folks who want to work collaboratively on this. And so,
can we put something out on the website that, you know, if people are interested?
Sure.
Because we did have a downtown committee for a while in the, 2009 to, and that's how we got the 2000, we did the streetscape, because we got a little grant.
One thing that Jane was very interested in is not expanding the scope beyond what is possible.
Yes.
And instead of talking about the big downtown, you know, major redevelopment, she really wants to keep this focus small. She wants to start small, keep the focus small, and then conclude that project and say, we've done this
now
small piece, we started with this one step. And she really wants to be able to achieve a step forward. I certainly respect that choice, and I would agree with that.
In the 2013 one, there was some doable, I mean, that was the criteria for the grant, or why we ended up with who we got, was they were supposed to come up with a list of things that we could do ourselves. So make sure Jane gets that, and we could work with Kevin to sort some of that doable things done. Because whatever Kevin was doing, we were going to incorporate it.
Part of our complete streets streetscape policy is also about providing spaces for bicycles to travel along the same paths as traffic, but in separate lanes. And about a month and a half ago, I spoke with Kevin right around the time that North Main was repaved. And we're going to be looking at ways to change the striping of the sides of that road. It may narrow the travel lanes at parts. Instead of being 18 feet or 20 feet wide, they might come down to 14 feet or 13 feet wide, but that would also allow for a dedicated bicycle lane along much of that road, North Main from Sugarloaf Street and the Elm Street extension, or Elm Street intersection up to about the high school entrance. It would make it much safer for bicycles and still keep parking along the sides of the road. So that's one of the things we'll be looking at, and that's something that's going to be very cheap to do. So that's ongoing. As you're aware, we were able to work out some of the kinks in the reimbursement request process for the MSBA related to the school roof. I sat with Brenda for about a half an hour today. We have the packet essentially ready to go. We're simply waiting for the signatures from RDA and from Pink & Company. As soon as we get those, I'll need Carolyn's signature on that, and then that will go out next day air or whatever to the MSBA.
Since we're spending money and we can only do one submission a month, I was hoping that we could, at least this one would be the next day delivery or something. Is that all right with you? pay the extra cost to make sure it gets down there, so it's submitted in July.
It's going to be next day or second day with tracking and all of that.
Didn't they say that it all could be done electronically? I thought they said it could be done electronically, and it didn't have to be, it didn't have to have your original signature.
The signatures can be done through scans. It doesn't have to be wet ink.
Right.
But the physical paper has to arrive by mail at the MSBA.
Hmm.
They need the full reimbursement application plus copies of all the invoices.
Okay. No, I mean,
form.
I can't, even if it's $25, it's not that much.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah. So,
no, because we want our money.
What's that?
We want our money.
Yes. Yeah. Yes, get it there.
We're paying
what, 400 something thousand dollars for advice on how to shingle from these people. I don't think that, you know,
well,
the $20
should,
is,
I was
can
just
we
running
send
to
it
buy
COD?
You that I felt like it was a cost effective way to get some cash back in.
Yes.
Okay.
I also
short
spoke with Brenda. I also spoke with Brenda about the reimbursement schedule and about when we're going to apply for the next reimbursement. It will likely be after the next warrant. When the warrant gets signed on the 10th, we'll likely, as soon as we can, turn that around and ask Pink and Company to start the second reimbursement process. Even though I actually thought it would make more sense to wait until the warrant on the 24th, but Brenda suggested that due to vacation schedules and so on and so forth, it makes more sense to process it a little bit earlier in the month. I also expect that reimbursement request will probably involve something around $500,000 or $600,000 worth of expenses. So it does make sense to step up our costs in that way and to try
especially,
to get reimbursement.
Especially when I found out that the sign-offs and stuff, I mean, they're talking October for a sign-off.
Yeah.
So we're
for
not going to get
sure.
final money until October.
Until, yeah, at the earliest, probably
so,
closer to November.
So having a September, another September submission is probably
yep.
okay.
Yep, exactly. And we expect the September submission will happen early as well. Because by September 10th or 15th, we will likely have been billed the majority of MDM's expenses. And that's the bulk of the project cost. So.
But I find it uneasy to hear these people talking about they need time to sign this and do this and do that, where the contractor is already laid out $500,000.
Mm.
You
yeah.
know, and it's just such an unfair process, you know.
I know.
And these
I agree.
People, you know,
they take time.
They
I
take
mean, but
time,
what,
the whole process.
And we said this morning, the end of the month is Friday.
Yeah.
So if we don't get it in by Friday,
yeah,
you'll wait another whole month.
Well. Then it counts as the August submission, so we can't get more money in August.
Right.
We have to wait till September. And so
yeah. Send
I
it.
Was like, let's sign it.
I'll drive
out
it
the
down
door.
There myself.
No, we're going to, yeah. Well, it's $25 more money. Just send it out. But it's worth it. To.
Yeah, it's
okay.
It's not,
I just didn't want you to have any problems, but I was going to tell Doug, just send it next day.
No doubt. Yeah.
So it gets there Friday.
Well, you could get a bunch of mosquitoes again. They could fly it down there for us.
I knew that was coming.
It's
you can
okay.
see I don't
it's
have
okay.
a problem with sending it, but it's okay. the mosquitoes. I gotta.
I've heard of drone delivery,
but it's going over.
Drone delivery.
Yeah.
Drone delivery.
I'm getting pretty sick of this mosquito business. There's a lot of politics involved in it.
Yes,
there
sure.
are a number of other things, but I think I've been keeping you up to date with the daily reports. I've received positive feedback from all three of you on that, and thank you for it. And I think it does work a lot better. As I mentioned to Kip earlier today, it helps me to keep on track with all these tasks that are happening and to make sure that I'm updating you consistently, but also making sure that I'm keeping myself on top of the various mm-hmm. projects that are happening. So overall, it's a good thing. The only other thing I wanted to remind you is some dates. We've already talked about the sewer study. The sewer rate study presentation at 6 on the 2nd of August. The mosquito presentation at 11 a.m. on the 3rd of August. The DPW truck bid opening is at 2 p.m. on the 4th of August. It's 2 p.m. in the afternoon. On August 10th will be the final Highway Garage Building Committee meeting. An agenda for that will be delivered by the chair, Ralph Healy, probably in the next day or two. That will be at 11 a.m. on the 10th of August, and that will likely be the last committee meeting for
you
that.
You come to that.
I had a quick quick question. I saw maybe through an email and stuff that the site was cleaned up a bit, or is that right? Because, I mean, thinking they're closing that down, I just thought we didn't want to leave anything hanging.
Absolutely. This past week, Kevin and his crew have done yeoman's work to make sure that the bulk of the Oxford property is clean. And it is.
Great.
There was, at last I saw, there was one stack of some galvanized, side railing that you see on the sides of highways, highway railing or highway guardrails. That was basically it. His crew cleaned up all the materials that had been just stored in the open lot, basically took all of the, they knocked down the weeds quite a bit with the brush hog. And so the site actually looked very, very good.
Good.
A lot of the materials were simply disposed of. The steel scrap was brought to Kramer's, and hopefully the town will see some benefit from that. Maybe we'll see.
Yep.
And there was very little trash stored there, some deep plastic barrels and that kind of thing. We're working out the details of the final cleanup with the potential buyer, as well as ECS, which is a company that does environmental cleanup. So we're in good form there. The lot does look great.
That's great.
Kevin's even gone so far as to make sure that folks who normally park on the lot are aware of that when the property changes hands, likely parking on the lot will no longer be allowed.
Yep.
And it's also very likely that the gate at the end of Coates Avenue, right at the culvert, will be closed. So through traffic, as people sometimes cut through that lot to go between South Main Street and Sugarloaf, that will no longer be possible. And that's fully up to the new owner of the property to do that or not. So there's that. There is some private property that has been on town-owned property for a while.
Mm-hmm.
The owner has been informed to remove that.
That's
about it. The lot really does look good. And I want to commend Kevin and his group for doing great work.
Thank them very much.
Side note, the Coates Avenue block building, we did come to some positive conclusions, as I mentioned.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we're going to be seeing closing papers on that within about a month. We'll finally wrap up the last niggling little details, and hopefully we can get that building sold so that Thayer Street Associates can start to expand their business, as they said they've wanted to for some time. So I'm looking forward to that sale.
Good.
I think that's about all that I have, really. Again, I'll be updating you on a daily basis on everything that's going on.
I have a question about that barn. Near Paul Alice's house.
Mm-hmm.
I guess at one point Kevin had mentioned that he could use that for storage, but if the bakery buys that land, how does that barn now fit into it? Is the only access going to be up Paul's driveway to that barn?
Paul's driveway is Jewett Avenue, and it's a public right-of-way.
Right, but that is the only access to that barn.
Yep.
Okay, so like right now they could come across the lot, but once we transfer ownership, then it would have to, I just wanted to be clear.
Absolutely.
I wasn't sure.
And when we had the bid opening for that, broadly speaking, one of the factors was the value of the bids.
Right.
Broadly
understand.
Speaking. It's more valuable for us, at least right now, to continue to use that barn as cold, dry storage for snow plows in the summer, for mowing decks in the winter. Than to sell it at far lower than, valuation. So, and that means that it's not every day or even every week that someone's going there to pick up equipment or drop off equipment. So access along Jewett Avenue would be very, very minimal.
Yeah. Wow.
Is there anything else, Doug?
I don't think I have anything else other than... I am requesting an executive session for an extremely brief discussion, vote, and signing of a contract.
Okay.
And I've got one other piece of material to provide you.
Okay.
That's it.
Okay. Is there a letter we're supposed to sign?
And ask for public comment.
Oh, did you have a letter for us to sign
McGovern?
For McGovern?
I do, yes. I apologize, yes. You've got a copy of the letter in your packet.
This is
in regard to the FERC regulatory process for gas pipelines. This was recommended. Well, you can speak to this better than I am, sure.
Well, what it is, we've one of the multiple committees, but this was the FERC Hog Advisory Committee. And what this came out of all the things that we would like to see corrected. In the process, right?
Okay.
I mean, obviously, we'd be lucky to get one or two things, but the idea was to list everything.
That was, that you were finding an issue with this when we went through this.
These are things that we'd like to correct so that should another pipeline try to come through, FERC would be more sensitive to local communities.
I read some of this, and it's funny because some of my opinions are, they sound like I support the pipeline, which I don't really do, but, you know, the concept of having, whether it's oil or gas, go from point A to point B, traveling through a pipeline, just makes so much more sense to our environment than trucking it, you know.
And, it does,
and
it does.
Too many times people overlook that, and that although I understand that leaks can happen, environmental, and the environment can suffer from that, but they still happen with trains and trucks all the time. And the loss of life is much greater in industrial accidents like that.
I think you would find that what we were talking about is that it had to be for local use. I mean, domestic use versus...
Yeah, I mean, there's things about, you know, the letter talks about, you know, we don't want the pipeline to go through the community, and then they're going to put it on a tanker and take it overseas. I mean, I understand that. If you're going to, you know, put a pipeline in for everyone's benefit that's here, that's one thing. If it's just for a company's benefit somewhere else, that's
so
it's a whole different ballgame.
And that's basically, FERC still has the authority to do it, but this was just stuff that we came up as a committee, we came up during the process of it.
Yep.
Like I said, he's just putting it out there.
Yep.
I make a motion to sign this letter and send it to Jim McGovern.
Second.
Okay.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Actually, Doug, I know Peggy said just to send it to representative, but we should send it to our senators too. Oh, you have the senator one?
Actually, I've got 4 or 5 signature sheets.
Okay.
The expectation is that it's going to go to Jim McGovern plus Senators Markey and Warren.
Yep.
As well as Stan Rosenberg and Steve Kulik for their information.
Oh, perfect. Thank you so much. I didn't realize that.
Yep.
Okay. Public comment, Jeff? Were you here for anything?
Well, yeah, I have actually had several comments for tonight, but I'll wait on a few of them. The transfer station I have a concern about with some comments that I heard tonight. I'll wait for the right moment for that.
We'll be discussing that for, the upcoming budget year. We'll be discussing that for the upcoming budget year.
Yeah, no, and I understand.
No decisions,
Right. And then the sewer rate study committee, I understand there's a little bit of push, but hopefully we're not all of a sudden pushing so hard that we're trying to meet a timeline without having the opportunity to gather all the information that we really need to make a good recommendation as far as the new or core.
I don't think I'm sorry to give you that impression.
Right.
We weren't. I don't think. Right?
No.
Okay. I mean wasn't my intention.
Right. No.
Okay.
Yep.
I just want to make sure
that's why there was never any
there's a learning curve there for everybody.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
There's a lot of info.
But that's why there was never any an end date, because it's totally discretionary for us. I mean,
because I know we have budget season coming up in that, but I don't want the committee to feel under the gun that they've got to come up with some magic number all of a sudden.
No, I the way I kind of heard it was that, you know, we set a rate for this year because we still got a lot of info, and then obviously.
Well, and that's why I said we can.
Yeah,
we could adjust it for the second rate if we had,
or
to.
Even a half rate if we knew ahead of time.
Yeah, the second half of the rate.
Totally. Yep.
And the other thing that I think is important, I hope you consider, is Doug laid out 3 different scenarios as far as the town administrator's position, and hopefully you consider what he presented there, because there is a lot to that.
Well, I didn't want to downgrade it, though.
Right. Well, it's very difficult because with the language and job descriptions, it's very difficult.
Correct.
The position's authority and responsibilities. And if that does that also diminish the pay scale? And also, do you get in a position where, and don't get wrong, we have some good department heads, but does that also get that person in a position where the department heads actually always have more authority than that position? So I guess you got to walk a fine line there. And
yeah,
some of the other things, I think job descriptions are very, very important. And if there's requirements within those job descriptions, when people interview, those job descriptions are presented to them, they pretty much know what they're signing on for. Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, that's what you live with, because if you agree to it, you know, to also be in a year or two and want, well, now I'm going to maintain this license or this certification or something like that, well, you kind of knew that coming in with the job certification, I mean, with the, you know, with the job description. So I think we have to be a little careful with that, too, as far as, and I'm not saying, my only concern is if we start changing all these descriptions and that. What happens if some of these people also leave, they're not here? Mm. Are we going to be able to, and I'm not saying we're
find somebody else.
Tailor-making the job descriptions to the people we have, because that's not the case.
That was a concern.
But I'm just saying, if they leave, are we going to be able to get qualified people to meet those job descriptions that we're creating?
That's why I...
Are you talking about the position the that was discussed at the highway department?
No, not even,
okay.
Not even
all right.
Just any, broadly.
Reason. Sure.
I know there's been other issues in that.
Sure.
Some of these job descriptions and placement on steps and so on and so forth. And I think we just have to be a little careful to make sure.
Absolutely,
Jeff. When we place people, we're placing them in the right position with the right expectations, so everybody's clear on them, so we don't run into problems.
That's why.
Absolutely.
That's why I wanted us to. I didn't think it was a big deal because of it wasn't changing the job description. It was just
right.
a word. I just had a problem with one word.
Well, that,
and
okay,
that
you know,
it wasn't.
Word,
I know, words. But it was so, it was conveying something different from what the
right.
job really is. And so I wanted a descriptor of what the job really was. But we had this discussion, as you remember, with Mark, downgrading to a coordinator, and I felt that the coordinating job, and that we argued back and forth because that was too lesser of a job.
Right.
And
right.
and we had, I mean, there was a lot of people in that discussion, as you remember.
Mm-hmm.
And it ended up being that, okay, we kept it as a town administrator.
Right.
But the coordinator thing was just too, I mean, that was a much of a, I mean, that wasn't much more than executive assistant
well,
or whatever.
I think that's why it's important for the
yes.
board to
I agree.
Really take all this into consideration and determine what type of responsibilities and authority you want that position to have. So, but that's all I have.
One thing I can do, and I will make a point of doing this tomorrow, is to provide the board members with, I've got several job descriptions I've pulled from several different towns for town administrators, but what I can also do is seek out job descriptions for town managers as well as town coordinators. So you get an understanding of the potential differences. There's a lot of similarities between them. There's some differences, but if you go through them on a cursory way, you'll get a sense as to the flavor of each. And I will also do my darndest to find salary ranges for each of the three.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll advise to take a look at those, take that into consideration, take a look at the descriptions and the subtle differences or the similarities between them, but also take a look at the requirements for each, the job requirements, because that may also affect a potential hiring process. So.
One of the concerns that I have is I read the study from, I think it was the Department of Revenue.
Yeah.
From 2014.
And they talked about, a strong administrator and stuff like that. And the problem that I see is that more than likely the person who is going to be the town administrator is going to be a business administrator. And that's their goal. Running a town is a business. But within that business, you have several businesses that are totally opposite. Now, you have an education business, and those people deal with education. And then you have a construction division, mm-hmm. and you can't expect the education people to understand the construction end of it, or vice versa. Then you have people that are dealing with, you know, sewage treatment, and they're all specialized. Now you're going to take an administrator and put them into these positions, and they don't understand those businesses. So, you know, if you have a construction business, a big construction business would have a business manager, but that business manager deals with the construction all the time. Or if you have a university, you have, you know, that overhead person. They understand that. And a town administrator has to be really very diverse, and that's what becomes very complicated and very concerning to me, that if you give this strong administrator all the authority, or most of the authority that the Board of Selectmen might have, that, you know, they might do good in really good one area, maybe not so good in another area, and really bad at another one. But they might become frustrated because they just see the managerial aspect of it and not the implementation of running that business.
Mm. So to counter that, regardless of the type of business, mm-hmm. every business office manages payroll and taxes. And I'm thinking just commercial businesses now for purposes of argument. And if you're doing payroll, you're doing it according to rules that are set down by federal and state law. Right. If you're doing taxes, you're doing that according to rules set down by federal and state law. And those rules don't change whether you're a construction business or a housekeeping business or a gardening business or landscaping business or whether you run a restaurant. Those rules stay the same. A town administrator, you're right, it cannot be a specialist in libraries and highway operations or sewers and education. That certainly can't be the case. Even just similar things, even inside the building of the town hall, the town administrator can't know everything about the town clerk's job as well as the accountant's job. Right. But that's why you have other people to do those things. But the town administrator does, in many towns, does manage people, does have the same set of rules one town to the next that they have to follow: public procurement, hiring and firing, maintaining public record, personal records, and down the line. Those rules don't change one town to the next. I hear what you're saying. Nobody can be a specialist in a wide variety of areas, but that's why you have a police chief who's specially trained, a highway department superintendent who has special skills, a library director who has special education in those fields.
Right.
The town administrator's job is not to micromanage those departments, but to make sure those departments are operating according to the strictures set down by Mass General Law and the bylaws of the town.
I get that, but you know, I still think that, you know, to your point of the payroll and stuff like that, that's another business. That's an accounting business within that.
Sure.
You know, so sure. I like the fact that one person, you have a person to go to. I'm just very leery of, if it doesn't work out, you know, how disastrous it can be.
And you're locked in to, if the person is doing a mediocre job, you're stuck with that person because you're not able to get rid of them.
Mm.
And they mostly live out of town, so there's some accountability issues. And I think we have something to work with.
Yeah.
And we'll just talk about it. We aren't doing anything drastic.
Yeah, no.
Good point, Jeff.
Thank you.
Always. There is.
Yeah. There is, and it's difficult, it's hard.
It is.
You know, it's hard. You know, that's why I'm racking my brain thinking of all these different scenarios and stuff, and you know.
I guess I totally get what you're saying, that a person can't be a specialist in all areas, and that's why you have strong department heads who know their skills and who know their abilities, and who also manage their crew to do the jobs, you know, in that department. That's the theory that's behind that was behind Mass Ed reform in the 90s, when control of a school was handed over to the principal exclusively, and that the only person the principal answered to was the superintendent.
Superintendent hire the principals, principals hire their staff. You know, and that chain of command helped to make for,
that's
in theory,
when we went downhill.
In right, exactly. The theory was that, yeah, specialized people hiring those. You know, that.
Mm-hmm.
Well, and well, all of that again at the top is that
can,
the expectation is that the school committee is overseeing the superintendent and the budget.
Oh, and that has been real successful.
So,
just like this, like a select board overseeing a town manager. Yeah. Well, that's a good parallel. You can see I'm a little jaded. Okay. Should we go into executive session then?
Yes, please. I believe you've got it written in the agenda.
Yes.
Where did I put that?
Hey, good night, Jeff. Have a nice night. Thank you for
coming. Thanks for coming.
Executive session may be called for the purpose of discussing the purchase, sale, exchange of real property if the chair declares that an open meeting may be detrimental to the effect on the negotiating position of the public body, which I do.
I make a motion to go into executive session.
I second the motion.
Aye, McDaniel.
Aye, Carolyn Ness.
Aye, Henry Camosa.
Entering executive session at 9:10 p.m. Thank you. We will come out of executive session only to sign the warrant and to adjourn.
Yes.
Okay. Very good.
Did you have the warrant here?
Did you have
it's in the office.
Okay.